Hey guys, this is Frank Yecker, and you're listening to Submission Radio.
Hey, this is Rich Franklin.
What's up, everybody? This is Chris Lieben.
This is Diego Sanchez.
Randy Couture.
Alex Overeem.
Hi, this is Stephen Bonner.
This is Don Fry.
Hey, I'm Phil, Mr. Wonderful Davis.
TJ Dillashaw.
You're listening to Submission Radio.
Submission Radio.
Submission Radio.
Submission Radio.
You're listening to Submission Radio.
Welcome to Submission Radio. Dennis Grout here with Casper Ozlowski on the 31st of May. It's a pleasure to have you guys. We have a big, big, big record-breaking episode of Submission Radio for you guys.
Yeah, six guests. Count them. Six guests, the most guests that we've ever had on the show. And it is a pretty stacked lineup, I'm happy to say. So, to kick off the show, we've got Chris Van Heerden. Who is that, you might be asking yourself as an MMA fan? Chris Van Heerden is a former boxing champion in the welterweight division, more commonly known these days as the man who Conor McGregor sparred with most recently, I think about a week ago or 2 weeks ago. So we've got Chris on the show to talk about that sparring session specifically and a bunch of things surrounding rumors regarding Conor McGregor and fighting Floyd Mayweather and all these kinds of things. Max Holloway will be joining the program or returning to the program to talk about his fight next weekend at UFC 199 against Ricardo Lamas. Hector Lombard is going to be on the show as well. He's got a fight against Dan Henderson. I'm super pumped to talk to Hector. We haven't had him on the show in ages. Gunnar Nelson, I mean, Submission Radio alum, if we've ever had one, he's returning to the show to talk about his victory over Albert Tumanov, a whole bunch of things in the future, and a couple more guests, believe it or not, Ariel Helwani. Right, we have never had him on the show before. A lot of people have always wanted us to get Ariel on the show, so we've got a brief interview with Ariel. Bear in mind, we did interview him a couple of days ago. It was, I believe, the day after he interviewed Nate Diaz. So a lot of the content is about the Nate Diaz interview, you know, what to do with Nate Diaz, Conor McGregor, BJ Penn, IV bands, all that kind of stuff. So we've got a juicy interview with Ariel Helwani, and then, of course, we're going to be breaking down UFC Fight Night 88. Because we've got so many interviews already, we're not going to have a lot of time. So we've enlisted the help of Robin Black. He's going to be carrying us, and we're going to be talking to him about UFC Fight Night 88. So, I mean, it's a stacked show.
Yeah, that's right. Fun times all around. Plus, me and Casper will break down our thoughts on the new X-Men movie. X-Men Apocalypse. We're going to give you guys our official Timothy Johnson mustache rating. It's been a while. Will we get a good one? Stick around to find out. That's going to be at the very end of the episode. And next week, obviously, UFC 199 is going to be a huge, huge card. To me and Cass, we're going to have a special edition of Submission Radio, just breaking down and focusing on that event. It's going to be a light version of Submission Radio. No guests next week. We just want to focus on the fights, give you our thoughts, and we might have a journalist or two in the midst as well, helping us out with that. And of course, your fan questions, we have been receiving them. We don't have any time to go through any today, but next week we'll be answering fan questions. And if you have some, info@submissionradio.com is where you send them. We read through them, we look through them, we put them in the vault, and then we bring them out on shows like next week. We have some time to really cover them and go through them. So that's all very exciting. But without further ado, Cassie mentioned it's a big, big show. We have a lot of guests. So let's get to it. We've got our first guest on the line, and you're about to introduce him.
All right, guys. Our next guest is one of the most successful boxers from South Africa, former IBO welterweight champion, a former IBF international welterweight champion. It's a pleasure to welcome Chris Van Heerden to Submission Radio. How's it going, Chris?
Well, guys, thank you for having me. It's an honor and a pleasure to be on the show, and looking forward to it. It's been a busy 2 weeks.
Yeah.
Oh, for sure. Well, I mean, Chris, you made headlines everywhere when fans saw you boxing, sparring with Conor McGregor. Tell us, how exactly did this come together that you ended up sparring with Conor?
Yes, you know what? I fought on April 16th. I had a fight in Las Vegas, and we won it. And I went back home to South Africa to visit my mom and dad and the family. So I took a little holiday. Got back to Los Angeles, and I walked into the gym 3 days later, and everyone is asking me questions like, am I back in training? And I was like, I'm back in training. And they're like, are you back in sparring? And I was like, I'm not yet back in sparring. I only got back now, getting over the jet lag. And I said, why? And they said, no, because there's someone that wants you to spar with him. And I was like, who's this someone? And they said, no, don't worry. Just, he's on his way. If you don't mind, would you wait at the gym? So I stood at the gym and I was waiting. And the next moment, Conor McGregor walks into Box and Burn here in Los Angeles. And I knew exactly, I knew it was Conor. And I was just excited. And Conor and myself introduced each other to each other. And he knew that I was a boxer because he said, hey, Chris, heard a lot of good things about you. So obviously the guys at the gym told him about me. And he said, I believe you're a southpaw. I said, yes. And he says, do you mind helping me with on a few occasions with sparring? And the first thing, you know, any fighter, a fighter wants to fight. He's not scared. And the first, my first reaction was, anytime, you just say, do you want to go now? And they all had a laugh. And he was like, no, we'll do it tomorrow. And they took my contact details, and that was the start of it.
That's pretty awesome. I mean, here comes, obviously, this, you know, big star in Conor McGregor, and he's seeking you out. How did that feel that he, you know, specifically wanted to spar with you?
You know, I don't know. Obviously, the guys at the gym or whoever told him about me, and I bet his management team and them checked into me a little bit. And it just felt good to know that, you know what, I knew to jump the boat right now, because I knew with the whole Mayweather-McGregor talks in the line, and now me sparring with McGregor, I knew my name would just blow up so much. I knew it.
And I
saw the opportunity and I grabbed it.
Now, you're actually, for people that don't know, because there is a big fan base here in Australia, New Zealand, and across America that are listening to this program. You're a big, big star in South Africa. So maybe perhaps he heard about you there, but probably not that much experience sparring MMA fighters before. Was that the first time that you sparred an MMA fighter in a boxing sparring match?
Yes, that was the first time I've ever laced gloves up against an MMA fighter. And Conor McGregor has got about 15 pounds on me, so it's bigger than me.
Mm-hmm.
But the argument was for myself. I wanted to answer a question personally for myself. That's why I did it, because the argument is I wanted to prove to myself that no MMA fighter in a stand-up game will be able to handle a stand-up professional champion boxer in a stand-up game, because this is what we do for a living. And I wanted to prove to myself that I can go with even an MMA guy like Conor McGregor, which is the biggest name in UFC at the moment. And I wanted to prove it to myself. So that was the first time I did it.
Mm-mm. I'm just wondering, obviously you mentioned you wanted to prove it to yourself. Was there a bit of pressure there for yourself as well? Because obviously you wanted to...
Not at all. No pressure at all. You know what? I enjoy getting in the ring. People that know me know that my happy place is when we lace up the gloves and we go toe-to-toe. That's my happy place. So absolutely no pressure. I was excited because I knew that a big name like Conor McGregor and myself, once this gets out, this is going to be huge for me. So I was just excited to get this going and see how good Conor McGregor is in his stand-up game.
Mm. By now, most people have seen the leaked footage of you know, a small part of that sparring session. Afterwards, were you satisfied? Did you feel like you had proven that to yourself?
Well, the footage that leaked out, I only afterwards found out I saw it all over the internet. I was like, how did this get out? Because I had no idea that this footage was taken with the sense of getting it out there. So people's got to understand, sparring is sparring. We're not in there to kill each other, you know? And then again, I just came off a one-month holiday back in the gym. First time I laced up gloves. And I've got footage on my phone that would probably shock everyone. But I was happy. I was happy because I, you know, I knew I was in control every round. And I was happy with what I wanted to feel.
Mm-hmm. You said that you've got footage that might shock everyone. What about it would be shocking?
No, I got, you know, once those footage got out, people were filming footage, and I've got sparring footage where you can clearly see I am the professional boxer and not Conor.
Mm-hmm.
Let's talk about that for a second. I mean, you mentioned that you were competitive in every round. What did you take away from Conor's boxing skills? I mean,
Let me answer this question to you guys, because I know everyone wants to know this. Can Conor McGregor box?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, I never knew Conor McGregor has actually got an amateur boxing background as an Irish boxer and Irish champion. Can Conor McGregor box? Yes, he can. Okay, I was shocked as how well he can handle himself in the ring. You can immediately see that Conor has got a boxing background and that he knows how to use his hands. Yes, Conor can fight. It's the important things that showed, like the footwork, the balancing of the feet, crossing the feet, where he places his feet, his defense, the small things that a boxer is so focused on that Conor McGregor lacks. And it was easy for me to capitalize on mistakes like that. I would honestly say if Conor McGregor can focus on his stand-up game on boxing, let's say he can get a 2-3 month training camp where he can mainly focus on boxing, on his boxing ability, and polish some skills, some small mistakes. Conor can shock a lot of boxers out there by what he might do.
How do you think he would do if he were to transition in boxing? Do you think he would go far? What
honestly,
do you think?
Honestly, very, very honest answer from my side, I think he could do well. I think there's some fighters out there that Conor would give a hard time. If he can transition into boxing and merely focus on the stand-up game and his footwork, you know what? You can see the background of boxing. He's got it. He's got that boxing ability. He does have it. And you know what he's very good at? Is his timing. He's got a good eye for timing. His precision on timing. His counter left hand. He loves it. And he's got it. Polish it. And it might just cause a lot of problems for a lot of guys.
It's interesting. You mentioned how it all happened, but the big question is, did he mention to you why he chose to do the boxing sparring? Obviously, a lot of speculation about him possibly fighting Floyd. Did he mention anything?
No, and we kind of put the question out. I was like, so what is this whole Mayweather thing going on? And he laughed about it. And he was like, you know what? Mayweather started it. He says, and I'm going with it. And he says, hey, everyone wants it. And if it's there, I'm going to take it. So that's all he said. That was it. And we all had a laugh about it. But then you got to ask yourself the question. He searched for Southpaw. Mayweather's not Southpaw. You know, you got to answer the question. But hey, it was good. It was a good experience. We sparred on two different occasions. We were supposed to do it on three different occasions, but after the footage leaked out and everything, it's just all collapsed.
So what happened after the footage leaked out? Does someone not want to spar, or how come you guys didn't
continue? No. It's just, I think there was just so much room and so much things going on, and then the next moment, you know, he's a businessman and he was in Vegas, so I guess it was just 2 months. We just had the two occasions.
Right.
Now, I mean, there's no need to ask if you think he can beat Mayweather. We all know the answer to that. But do you think there's any chance McGregor would be able to survive a whole fight with him?
This is my answer. Mm-hmm. Mayweather will end the fight whenever Mayweather feels like it. If Mayweather feels like stretching it out and playing around a little bit, he'll be able to do that. And if Mayweather feels like ending it within 4 rounds or 4-6 rounds, it is up to Mayweather. So I think I'm answering your question there.
Sure. And I'm just curious. I mean, the deck really is stacked against Conor McGregor in this fight. You just said to yourself, in your opinion, should he take the fight? If it's a possibility, should he take the fight? If it's, you know, for monetary reasons, because it would be a big fight.
Do I feel this fight should happen? No, I don't. I feel that there's more professional fighters out there, boxers, that deserve a shot at this than McGregor, because McGregor is a champion in MMA. If you take him to boxing, he's got a 0-0 record. There's fighters out there that live their whole life chasing this dream of fighting for a big day like this. And for this fight to happen between Mayweather and McGregor, it is not fair, in my opinion. Well, but Mayweather is the biggest name in boxing. McGregor is the biggest name in UFC. The pay-per-views are there. The supporters are there. The fans are there. Will it sell? Yes, it will sell. In my opinion, this will sell because McGregor's got such a following and Mayweather's got... It will sell. The money will be there. So, hey, it's a business. And if it's going to be made and McGregor gets that offer, yeah, go for it. But it's a one-sided fight, in my opinion. No disrespect to McGregor. I have nothing but respect for him and he proved it to me. But it's a one-sided fight against Mayweather.
Yeah, of course. And I mean, most people who know the fight game will say that. If the fight were to happen, though, would you be interested in helping McGregor prepare for Floyd?
Absolutely. You know what? I have no bad blood. You know, it would be an honor for me to still stick around. And I have no bad blood. You know, even with everything that's going on now, I believe, you know, people make up their own stories just to sell news. And there was some article that came out and said, I said that McGregor eats like a woman. And which I never said, go look at the interview. And then McGregor was like, in the Fox interview, McGregor was like, yeah, very disappointed in Chris and here and this and that. But it's because people started. But will I be interested in helping McGregor? Of course. It would be amazing to just stick him, see him try his best.
Mm-mm. And just on the final thing with McGregor before we move on to your career, I mean, the other big fight would be in MMA against Nate Diaz. We saw what Nate did to Conor on the feet in their last fight. Do you think Conor could improve his boxing enough to beat Nate Diaz in a rematch?
Yes. You know what? I spoke to Conor, and he is so positive. He actually said, you know what? He said, if I get a rematch with Nate, I'm now more confident than ever that I will beat him. Because he said to me, he said, I know where I made my mistakes. He says, I know, and it was in training camp. He says, I know where I made my mistakes. He says, and I will do better next time. He says, I'm confident that I will beat him. And I thought Conor was actually doing pretty well against Nate. But the weight showed, and the difference in size showed, and Conor got tired, and Nate, just the power of Nate just took over, and that's it. But in a rematch, I would back Conor.
Well, let me ask you. I know, obviously, you know, those things came out in the media. Are there any plans for you guys to do any more sparring, and do you think you'll be preparing him for Nate Diaz in any capacity?
I don't know. Honestly, my answer right now is I have no idea, because I haven't heard back from no one. Mm. And, you know, I did this out of the goodwill of my heart, because I knew I didn't get paid for this. People's got to understand. They say, how much did you get paid to spar with him? I got nothing to spar with Conor. I saw the opportunity and I grabbed it. It was out of my own will. He asked me. I said yes, because I knew this is going to blow up my name. Mm. So I didn't get paid to help him in any way. But do I think I will be approached? I don't know.
Mm-mm. Well, hopefully everything gets cleared up and there's more sparring in the future. Okay, let's talk about your career. After living in South Africa for 25 years, you moved to the USA in 2013. Tell us, why did you decide to make that move? And what was it like moving your whole life to a different continent?
You know what? I live with a vision. I'm a Christian, and I believe that the Lord is a bigger plan in my life. And I know what my heart desires is. And as long as I was going to stay in South Africa, I was never going to be able to attempt to achieve what I desire. And that is fight in California, fight in America, get to be amongst the biggest names in boxing. It wasn't going to happen for me back home. So I decided on one day, I said to my dad, I said, you know what, Dad? I said, I'm 25. I said, my time to take a risk is right now, and I'm going to do it. I said, I just got to have to go to America and see if I can follow my dream. And I packed my bags and I came to America. You know what? I gave up the most comfortable life. You know, a champion in South Africa, and everything was going my way. But I gave it all up for my dream, because when I grew up as a kid, my eyes were on Francois Botha. My eyes were on Corey Sanders. All these big names to fight Mike Tyson and fight Klitschko. So I grew up with role models, South African role models, trying and fighting in America. So I asked my dad, I said, who at the moment is in America, South Africans are in America, that's giving these kids of today hope? And we couldn't find one name. I said, I want to be that guy. Mm. I want to go to America. And I want to be that guy that inspires the kids in South Africa growing up with this passion of boxing to look up to me and say, you know what, Chris is there. Chris is amongst them. We can do it as well. And that is the main reason. And so far, I've been in America for just over 2 years, and my name back home has just blown right through the roof. You know what? I've achieved so much in 2 years on a very small scale. I was Miguel Cotto's main sparring partner, a superstar. I was Canelo's sparring partner, a superstar. I was trained by Freddie Rhodes, a South African trained by Freddie Rhodes. I fought at Madison Square Garden, and I won the IBF International title with Freddie Rhodes in my corner. I went on to spar with Ray Belcher and Fort Corvette. I went on to be amongst Sugar Shane Mosley. I sparred Victor Ortiz. And this is something that doesn't really happen for South kids in South Africa. And now they all look at me and they go, but Chris is amongst all these stars. Look at him. And that is what I wanted. That was my aim, was to inspire kids back home. That's why I packed my bags and I came to America.
Wow, that's extremely inspirational. And you mentioned, last year you had your first fight at the iconic Madison Square Garden. It's an arena that has eluded MMA fans for many years, and the UFC is yet to have a show there. What was that experience like for you? And, you know, was it like a dream come true to win there?
Yes. You know, you walk into Madison Square Garden, you feel the energy. It was like, wow, because the history in that is, 1955 was the last time a South African wheelie to wheel fought in Madison Square Garden. Wow. And won. And 60 years later, I won with Freddie Roach in my corner. I said, that is some achievement for myself. And the energy in Madison Square Garden, the atmosphere was amazing. It blew me.
Mm-hmm. Well, your last fight was almost 2 months ago, win in Las Vegas. When do you think we'll see you back in the ring? And is there any anyone particular that you'd like to face next?
My fight was April 16th, so it's just like 5 weeks ago. Mm. My fight was in Vegas, main event, CBS Sport. I took the fight on 3 weeks' notice, mm-hmm. and we came away with a good win. And I'm already back in training. I'm just, you know what, there's a little dispute between me and my management team, and we want to get out of that, and because that's just something slow in my career and I need to get out of it, and there's a possibility out of it. So I'm back in training, hoping for something to come out, like even during this interview, some promoter picks me up and say, you know what, we believe in that kid and we can make him grow. There's a name, you know. I feel after 10 years as a pro fighter, former world champion, being around so long, I would like to be in the fights with big names. And if you can ask me one name right now, right on the spot, I would say Robert Guerrero.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you're saying all the right things, Chris. You know, you're only 28. You've got an impressive record with, you know, only two losses. What are your goals in the sport before you retire? You've already accomplished a lot. You want the big names. What are your biggest goals in this sport?
I want to win a world title. I want to win a world title, fight on a big, big stage here in America for the worldwide to see in the main event. And like I said, I want the people in South Africa to wake up at 4 o'clock in the morning and watch me walk to the ring in a packed arena and give glory to God. That is my goal, and give glory to God, because I am truly blessed. I'm not lucky for what I've achieved so far. I'm truly blessed. You know what? The Lord knows I work hard. The Lord knows my heart desires, and I need people to understand and need them to hear that I am not lucky. I'm blessed, and I want to, you know, I'm still young. I'm 28 years old. If it's God's will, I might have another 7 years left, 35 years old. I want to achieve something in my life and set up a beautiful life, and just have some memories to look back at.
Mm-mm. Well, Chris, finally, before we let you go, like you mentioned, you were a sparring partner for Canelo for 6 weeks. We have to ask you, who do you think would win in the super fight between him and Golovkin? Do you think Canelo can do it?
I'm gonna have to say I've got to go with Triple G.
All right. Okay. Why is that? I mean, I think a lot of people are picking Triple G, but give us the breakdown.
Triple G is the bigger man. Triple G is the natural middleweight. Hmm. He fights at that weight. That's his weight division. He is the bigger guy. He's just, I would say, it looks like, I've never spotted him, so I can't say, but he's packing power in both hands.
Hmm.
He's consistent with his power, and he comes forward. Where Canelo is got that one-punch power where if he really throws it, he's going to knock out. He taps, player, but he's got that one-punch power, and I don't think he's going to be able to back Triple G off with only one punch power, where Triple G has power in both hands and is consistent. I think it would be too much for Canelo.
Mm. Well, there you go. You heard it from the man himself. Guys, make sure to follow Chris on Twitter at TheHeat001, on Instagram at ChrisVanHeerden001, and Facebook, Chris Van Heerden Boxing. He's extremely nice to all his followers and loves answering everyone's questions via social media. And he's obviously extremely nice, and as you can hear from this interview. Chris, thank you so much for taking the time chatting with us. All the best with your next fight, and we hope that it one day happens that all of South Africa will be waking up at 4 in the a.m. To watch you.
Thank you so much. Before I go, I want to leave you guys with one message.
Mm.
Remember these words to everyone that listens, and I live by these words. A lot of people miss the opportunity of success in life merely because they are afraid to take risks. Take that risk, and you'll see, it might be the best thing you've ever done.
Hi guys, it's Jana Jędrzejczyk, UFC strawweight champion. Listen to Submission Radio.
Alright guys, our next guest is currently on an 8-fight win streak that includes such names as Cole Miller, Cub Swanson, Charles Oliveira, and Jeremy Stevens. He takes on Ricardo Lamas at UFC 199 in a battle of high stakes. Max Holloway, welcome back to Submission Radio. How's it going today?
Going good, man. Thanks for having.
Now, Max, before we get into business, we got to ask, you had thumb surgery at the start of the year. How's the thumb? Are you all healed up and back to 100%?
Oh, yeah. That thumb surgery kind of bit me in my butt, you know. You guys know me. I like to stay active, and but it needed to be done, you know. I want to fight for a long time, and, you know, I got it done. It's way better than it was before, so I'm loving it, you know. I'm a fighter. I can't wait to get back in that cage and, you know, do what I do best, and that's fight.
Yeah, you're like the $6 million man. You got a brand new thumb, but you're also a big gamer. Was that torture for you, not being able to use your thumb to play games?
Yeah, you know, it did suck. You know, I was frustrating. You know, I was playing games and trying my best with my thumb. I kind of figured out a way to try to do it, but I still sucked at it, so it was kind of frustrating playing games. It was irritating.
So you still played games, even though your doctor probably told you don't use your thumb, correct?
Yeah, you know, he had it in a cast. It was pretty stiff, so it was like just imagine, like, keeping your thumb in like a thumbs up position, and that's how I was playing. I was trying to play like that, so it was hard.
Yeah, they call that one the Fonzie. I'm wondering, at any point, did you try and use your mouth or your nose or something? Did you come up with some new techniques to use joysticks without your thumb?
No, I figured out my controller knew met the wall a couple of times. So.
Well, what kind of games are you playing there, Max? Just for the people. I'm trying to figure out how much you actually needed your thumbs for these games. What are you playing?
I was playing shooting games. I needed them a lot. You know, aim, one is look left and right, and one is look up and down and turn around. So I was playing Call of Duty, Rainbow Six, trying to play some UFC, even Madden, but, you know, you need your thumbs for everything. So it wasn't good. It wasn't good at all.
Yeah, I can imagine. Now, this has also been a pretty quiet year for you compared to most years. You normally fight four times a year, and yet here we are in Maine, and you're yet to fight once. I mean, the chances of you fighting four times this year seems pretty slim. How do you feel about that? You know, have you been going a bit stir-crazy?
Yeah, you know, man, that's what you said, man. I'm using the four fights a year, always being in camp, always training. And, you know, it's kind of frustrating, you know, with this injury that I push it back. But all things happen for a reason, you know. I still believe that if everything comes out good and clean June 4th against Ricardo, you know, I think I can still squeeze in three more fights this year. So we'll see what happens.
Mm-hmm. So you're still going for three fights. Very impressive. You spoke for a long time and made it clear that you wanted to face Aldo, Edgar, or McGregor. In March of this year, you spoke to MMA Junkie and mentioned how a lot of people have been telling you that you need to win more fights to get these high-profile bouts. I mean, what do you make of that? You're on an 8-fight win streak. How many more fights do you think you need to finally get a high-profile fight like that?
I don't know, you know. It's funny because, like, I'm on this win streak or whatever, and then there's some guys saying that I need to win more to get a high-profile fight, and other guys saying that your win streak is invalid because you didn't fight high profile guys. It's wishy-washy, you know. I just want to fight the best guys. A lot of guys are like, oh, why are you not fighting these guys? You know, it's not my fault to pick. I'm calling out everybody in the division. It's UFC's giving me these fights, you know. So it's kind of, you know, not frustrating, but, you know, I wish I got to test myself against one of those three guys you named, but I'm glad I got Ricardo, a former title challenger. You know, he was ranked number 4 and I was ranked number 5, and we kind of just switched spots recently. We never fought, so this fight makes a lot of sense. You know, I'm looking forward to the challenge, and I can't wait to go out there.
I just want to clarify, when you know, people are telling you that you need more fights or more wins, who's telling you this? Is this from the UFC, or is this fans, or who is this?
It's fans, you know. It's on social media, so it's, I don't care, you know. It's whatever. It just amuses me. It's funny, you know, to see the way other people think. So I can't wait, you know. It was like, oh, why are you not fighting these guys? Some people ask. I'm like, you know, it's like, why are you asking me that? I'm asking to fight these guys. Go ask the UFC why the hell I'm not fighting these guys.
Mm-hmm. Well, when you picture yourself fighting for the UFC featherweight title, there's three names that stand out: Conor McGregor, Frankie Edgar, or Jose Aldo. Which one gets you most excited when you imagine yourself fighting for the belt? And do you think a win over Ricardo gets you a fight with one of those guys?
You know, we see what happens, you know, and first things first is Ricardo Lamas, you know, and all three of those fights get me excited, you know, any one of them, you know, it's, I can't, you know, they're all great, you know, three of them is all great guys, you know, they're top of their division for a reason, and I just want to prove myself against them, you know, we can go do that rematch with Conor, you know, a lot of people, I thought I was going to get Aldo, because a lot of people wanted to see that happen, and then, you know, there's something there with Hawaiians and Frankie, so, you know, all three of the matchups is interesting, and, you know, I just, you know, my head is focused on Ricardo right now. I got to get the job done June 4th, and then we start thinking ahead.
Mm-hmm. Sure, we'll talk about Ricardo in just a moment and sort of break the fight down, but before that, I just want to get your thoughts on the division. What do you think about the fact that Edgar and Aldo are fighting for the interim belt, even though, you know, McGregor was supposed to fight on that same night? Do you think it's fair, and do you think that originally should have maybe been one of them challenging for the featherweight title at UFC 200?
You know, at the end of the day, UFC gonna write me my checks. They're gonna do whatever they want to do, you know, I don't care. As long as I'm getting my paydays, my checks, and whatever, you know, it is what it is, you know. I could care less what was going on with that, you know, and I just stay in my lane, you know, keep fighting, keep winning, and get to that point where I'm up next for a title or I'm up in line for a big money fight.
Mm-hmm. And this is where it gets tricky, because if you are next for a title, it's an interesting situation, because it looks like, and from what we understand, the UFC want McGregor to fight Nate Diaz next. And I know you mentioned how you don't really care, but does a part of you sort of get annoyed by the fact that the champ is fighting, but the belt is not being defended?
You know, not at all. You know, whatever he's doing with his life is his life. You know, he have control. Mm-hmm. Whatever UFC, like I said, wants to do, they can go and do, you know, but... You know, at the end of the day, when my time comes and I want to do stuff like that, you know, let's do it. You know, it is what it is. You know, that guy's in a great spot. Conor's in a great spot doing that, getting money for him and the business. So it's business moves, you know, so you can't hate on somebody going out there trying to get paid.
For sure. I mean, you're talking about when your time will come. Your fight at UFC 199 feels a lot like a title eliminator. What do you think should happen if you beat Ricardo Lamas? You're an 8-fight streak. Ricardo would make it 9. That's a massive streak. Would you wait for the winner of Aldo and Edgar to face McGregor? Or would you just want to face the winner of Aldo and Edgar for the interim belt?
You know, who knows? You know, I want to fight. I want to stay busy. And I'll fight the winner of them, you know. I'll fight the loser of them. I'll fight whoever UFC wants me to fight. I'll fight if they need a last-minute replacement for that fight. There's a lot of possible things that could happen, and I'm just focused on, like I said, I'm focused on Ricardo right now. He got my attention, and we can start thinking about that after. We can start, if everything goes great on June 5th, we can talk to the UFC about what's next, you know, and whatever UFC wants, man. I keep telling them, whatever they want to do with me, I'm going to do it, you know. I'm a businessman. I'm here to collect paychecks. I'm here to get my name out there. So, you know, let's do it.
Here's a fun little incentive to get a title fight or become champion. We all saw that an unlikely contender in Stipe Miocic recently won the heavyweight belt, and now he'll be defending it in his hometown of Cleveland. Does it even give you even more motivation to win the belt so you can potentially defend it and finally fight at home in Hawaii?
Yeah, for sure. You know, that's funny. I just was talking about this with somebody, you know. And, yeah, you know, UFC Hawaii is always a push. Hashtag UFC Hawaii, tag Dana White, tag Sean Sharp, tag the UFC, tag Lorenzo Fertitta, tag them all, you know. Tag your auntie, your uncle, your brother, your whole family. And get it out there, you know. And I think if I can do my job, keep winning fight, you know, get a gold title around my waist, you know, they're not going to be able to deny it very long. You know, we got a bunch of Hawaiians now in the UFC making a case for UFC Hawaii too, so you know, I just can't wait for the opportunity.
Talk to us about just that in general. What would it mean to you to finally see the UFC in Hawaii and for you to potentially main event that card?
Oh man, you know, it'd mean the world. You know, it'd be a big accomplishment. You know, get to fight in front of my Hawaii crowd, in front of my family, my friends, and Yeah, it'd be groundbreaking. It'd be record-setting, and you know, it'd just be simply amazing.
Well, let's talk about your current opponent. When we spoke to Ricardo, he mentioned how his wrestling will be a big factor, and the last time you faced an elite wrestler in Dennis Bermudez, you didn't get your hand raised. How do you look at the wrestling aspect in this fight? Do you think it will be a big factor, and is this something specific that you're paying attention to in camp?
Yeah, you know, it's if this guy is coming into the fight thinking that he's gonna out-wrestle me, you better go think again, you know. So we got some surprises for Ricardo. I can't wait. And I'm already in his mind, you know. You can talk about it. His last couple fights, he's been trying to strike with everyone, and now he's trying to go back to his wrestling base. So we see what happens, you know. I'm here. I'm gonna do what Max Holloway does best.
You said that you believe that you're in his mind. What is it that makes you think that? What makes you see? What do you see in him that makes you believe that you're in his mind?
You know, his last couple of fights, if you watch all his fights, he don't wrestle nobody. You know, you think he's the striker guy. You know, even with Aldo, he struck with Aldo almost the whole time in that fight. So, you know, it's to him start thinking about focusing more on his wrestling for me, you know, it's kind of doubting himself already. So, you know, that's opening the door for more doubt and more doubt. So, you know, I'm looking even more forward to June 4th now, hearing this stuff. So I just can't wait, you know. We see what it is, you know. Max Holloway, I get ready for fights, you know. I get ready for everything, you know, wrestling, jiu-jitsu, striking, whatever it is, we get ready. And that's what happened, you know. Every Max Holloway fight you've been seeing, the last 8 fights, it's been a new one, you know. One win, new Max, the next one, another new Max, you know. And I strive myself for that. I strive myself off of growing as a fighter, being ready, showing something new every fight, and go out there and try and do my best to get my hand raised.
Well, the interesting thing about, you know, The way you see it, and obviously Ricardo Lamas potentially, you know, you being in his mind, he actually spoke about the striking aspect and said that on a technical level, you know, he's able to stand and trade with you. What do you think about that?
Hey, great for him. You know, I'm a big guy in what I said. The question before this, I'm a big guy in self belief. So, you know, if you don't have self belief in this game, then when you don't believe in your skill set, then not gonna go very far. So, you know, great for him, and you know, we see when it comes to June 4th. You know, I can't wait. I can't wait to go out there and just show my aspect of my game as a mixed martial artist.
We have to ask: will there be spinny attacks in this fight? Can we anticipate something crazy from Max Holloway?
You know, we see what happens. You know, when I go in there, I see how I feel. If everything's flowing, I feel great. Of course, you know, you're going to see, you know, but we see what happens, you know, one step at a time. And I just can't wait to fight, man. You know, it's been a long 6 months. It's been a great training camp, and I can't wait to go out there and show the world what I've been doing for the last couple weeks.
We can hear it in your voice. You sound like a man who just wants to get out there and fight already. The reason why we asked about spinning attacks is because we saw you were practicing your spinning back kicks on your training partner, Birdie Bird. Tell us about that.
Yeah.
Is he alive? Is he okay still?
Yeah, he's alive. He's alive kicking. So the whole idea is, like, we made this YouTube channel, and we wanted subscribers. You know, we only had, like, maybe 100. And it took us like maybe 2 months to get 100 subscribers. And he's like, "Well, I got this idea, you know, and you know, if we get X amount of, I think it was 500 subscribers by the end of this month, then Max can spin back kick me, you know." And that was the deal, you know. And then we ended up getting 2,200 or 2,000 subscribers. Actually, 1,500, I think.
Wow.
Like 2 weeks. Now we have like 2,500, but it was fast. Like, it was fast, you know. Somebody put it on Reddit or something, one of those forums or whatever, mm-hmm. and it went crazy. And my friend, like, called me up, like the next day and being like, I didn't think we was going to hit it. That's why I made that bet. I was like, but now it's time to freaking own up. And he did, you know, so cool to him.
Yeah, I mean, if you guys haven't seen the video, go on Max Holloway's YouTube channel. It's called The Brodies, and see his friend get absolutely broken in half with Max, a spinning back kick. Tell us about this YouTube channel. What exactly are you guys going for? And the name, De Brodies, what exactly is it? What does that mean?
You know, De Brodies is just a bunch of bros, you know, making videos, you know, a bunch of bros playing games. You know, I got a Twitch, follow me on Twitch at Bless MMA. You know, I try to Twitch every night. You know, that's another way to interact with me. You can ask me questions on there, and I answer them. And, you know, it's just me and him and a couple of other friends. We make YouTube videos of us video gaming, you know, playing Grand Theft Auto, Call of Duty, Rainbow Six Siege. And also, we've been making channel go towards vlogs, like training videos. Some of my sponsors, shout out my sponsors over there, you know, checking out some of my sponsors and making videos for them. So it just... a bunch of brodies hanging out, having a good time, and, you know, just a little insight in our life of gaming and, you know, just hanging out and training.
Well, you guys are off to a good start. Obviously, you got that 2,500 subscribers. I'm just wondering, you know, a lot of guys, people in general, are moving over to Twitch and are playing games on there, but, you know, MMA fighters specifically, like Rampage Jackson, Demetrius Johnson, obviously yourself as well. Are you looking to potentially make that a career one day? And if you can sort of sit at home and play games in your off time and, you know, make an actual career out of it, is that what you're going for?
You know, we see what happens, you know, anything is happening. I'm open to anything, you know, it's, I'm trying to get to that Demetrius Johnson and Rampage level, you know, but, you know, they seem to be loving it, especially Demetrius, you know, and a bunch of pro players actually do it and they make a living off of it. It was kind of crazy to me, so I'll definitely look into it, but, you know, right now my focus is on fighting and that's what I want to do.
Hey, Max, before we let you go, I want to also get your thoughts on a fellow Hawaiian, BJ Penn, getting pulled from UFC 199 very last minute, obviously due to the fact that around this whole IV thing. What was your reaction when you saw that? I mean, are you close to BJ, and were you disappointed when you realized he was off the card?
Yeah, you know, me and BJ, not too close, you know, and you know, it happened, you know. It's like, that sucked, you know. I guess so. It just so crazy, you know, how it happened. I heard it happened a while ago, and then now it's coming out before his fight, so it always sucked, you know. It's like, you know, your week, the hard work is pretty much done for a camp, and now you can't let it go, you know. It's like, you train all this for what at the end? For nothing. So I would seem to think that, you know, that just sucks. You have no off, you know. You're like, you're on the whole time, and you just can't get off, so... Yeah, man, that's not cool.
Yeah, disappointing, man. Disappointing for a lot of the MMA fans. But the good thing is there's still one Hawaiian on the card, and that's yourself. Give us the official prediction before we let you go. How do you see yourself beating Ricardo Lamas at UFC 199 on June 4th? How do you visualize it?
Max Holloway going out there, doing his thing, doing some cool shit, and getting his hand raised after whatever round it is. I don't care. You know, I'm going there. Let him choose when he want out, and when it's all said and done, getting my hand raised, raising the Hawaiian flag, and going on from there.
And now that you've got the YouTube channel and the Twitch, I mean, we expect an epic promo after you win. What are you going to be? What are we going for here? Can you give us a little preview? What kind of stuff would you say after you beat Ricardo Lamas? Now that you're a media person, just like us.
You know, it'd be like, you know, if you want to watch. On this handsome face live, follow my Twitch at Bless MMA. Follow my YouTube channel, The Brodies. We'll be putting up a bunch of fun shit on there. And follow me on Twitter and Snapchat and Instagram at Bless MMA. And just stay up to date. And let's all have fun. And don't forget to hashtag UFCOY and tag everybody that you possibly can know in it and spread the word.
There you go. Maybe a little shout out at the end to, for the winner of the interim belt, perhaps.
Yeah, for sure. You know, so we see.
All right, well, there you go.
Like I said, we see what happens. You know, let's go get that job. Let's go get the job done against him, and then you know, just tune in after the fight. If the job is done, then it's going to be way more epic than that. I can promise you.
Well, there you go. Well, we already know what you're going to tell Joe Rogan in the post-fight speech, but guys, obviously, we can't wait to see how you fight Ricardo. Don't forget to catch Max Holloway take on Ricardo Lamas at UFC 199 next weekend on June 4th. As you mentioned, you can follow him on Twitter and Instagram at BlessedMMA, and check him out on Twitch and YouTube, DaBrodies, D-A Brodies. Make sure to subscribe, give him some followers. Max, thank you so much for taking the time and chatting with us. We appreciate it, and good luck in the fight.
Oh, thank you, man. Appreciate you guys. You guys have a great one.
Hey, what's going on, guys? It's Demetrius Johnson, the UFC flyweight champion of the world, and you're listening to Submission Radio.
Well, guys, this one has been a long time coming. You may know our next guest from his excellent work with the MMA Beat, MMA Hour, and his event coverage. A fellow SB Nation alum, he is MMA Fighting's own Ariel Helwani, and he joins us here on Submission Radio for the first time, may I add. Ariel, welcome to Submission Radio.
Guys, it is a pleasure to finally be on your great program. Truth be told, I have been begging you to have me on for the last couple of years, so I'm happy that you finally obliged. Thanks for squeezing me into this week's show.
If people only knew the reality of how much begging went from Submission Radio to the great Ariel Helwani. Man, seriously, it's great to have you on. Now, we know how busy you are, and appreciate the time we have talked to you about your excellent interview with Nate Diaz this past week. We know that this McGregor fight is the big money one, but if it doesn't happen for Nate Diaz, and yeah, we're getting straight into it, you know, with obviously Nate Diaz saying that Lawler and GSP are his brother's fights, if you're in the UFC's shoes, who do you give him next?
Wow, that is a great question. I like how you waste no time. You get right into it.
Yeah.
I appreciate that about you guys. That is a conundrum, and I think that's why they're working so hard to make this fight. I think it's because Conor has explicitly told them that this is the fight that he wants, and Nate has, in a roundabout way, said the same. And I think at the end of the day, look, both guys are asking for a lot of money, but let's not forget the entity that is, you know, that stands to make the most is the UFC. They're going to walk away with the lion's share of this profit if this fight actually happens. And I do believe at this point that this fight, which was sort of criticized and maligned when it was first announced, the rematch, I think it's never been more interesting and never been hotter as far as what the fans think about it. And I think that it could actually get up to 2 million pay-per-view buys if done correctly at this point. So I don't even think that they're looking at other options right now. They really want to make this fight. They want to get it done. And I wouldn't be surprised that if they don't get it done, Nate takes an extended period of time off until something else materializes, because A, he did make a lot of money off the first fight at 196. And he has proven that if he doesn't get what he wants, he's very willing to sit out. And he was willing to do that when he was making 50 and 50. So you can imagine how he feels when he's making a few million.
Mm-hmm. Well, Dana White has said in the past that he doesn't push the needle. We obviously know that he does. But I'm just wondering, Ariel, how much of a star is Nate Diaz? And is it at a point where the UFC need to recognize the fact and treat him more like a Rousey McGregor, one of the biggest stars in the company?
Look, there is something to be said for the fact that sometimes the Diaz brothers are a little bit difficult to deal with from, you know, a promotional standpoint. They're not going to show up, and you know, they at times can be rough around the edges, but on the flip side, that's what makes them so beloved. I mean, they are so beloved. They are beloved for the exact same reasons that many times fans have criticized John Jones for not being real. The reason why the Diaz brothers are so beloved is because everyone thinks that they are real. Everyone believes that they are real. So even though they may have, you know, a bunch of losses here or there, you know, won few, lost a few, whatever, not going on the longest winning streaks, people connect with authenticity. And so that's you know, sometimes what, that's the double-edged sword with them. Sometimes it, you know, it stings them, but you know, it's made them into the stars that they are today. And I do believe that in the UFC right now, it's, you know, it's McGregor, Rousey, and Nate Diaz. Like, they are the top three draws. And when Nick comes back, I think that he will benefit from this push that Nate has experienced. So, look, I think that the UFC wants to push Nate. I think that they have to get on the same page with a few things. But if I'm being honest, I think they could do a better job as well. I mean, at times, I think that the UFC could do a better job in total, in the sense that, you know, there's just so many fights. There's so many fights out there, and they have to go week to week to week. This week, they're preparing for Cody Garbrandt and Almeida. That's a fantastic card. And then you have 199, and then you have, you know, Ottawa, and then you have 200, and all those cards on that week. And then you have South Dakota, and then you have Chicago, and then you have Atlanta. So the thing is, it's like, when can you take a step back and push guys without, you know, muddying the waters and getting people off track as far as what your next event is? So that's the tough game that they play. But for certain superstars, you got to put a little more into it. And I hope that they now recognize that, you know, that Nate has that star power and deserves that push.
For sure. All right, let's discuss this whole McGregor situation. We know it's looking like McGregor's heading back to featherweight, but or potentially not if he does fight Nate Diaz. But, you know, if you had a choice and if we really do have McGregor for maybe more of a limited time than originally thought, what do you think the next fight that makes sense would be for him? Are you still sticking with him facing Nate Diaz and only Nate Diaz? Is it as much of a fight that makes sense for him as for Nate Diaz?
That is a really good question, because there is a part of me that would love to see him fight Frankie Edgar.
Mm.
And even if he does get to fight Nate Diaz in August, I hope that win or lose, he defends his title against Edgar if Edgar wins. Aldo, yeah, I'd like to see that as well, but not as much as the Edgar fight, because we saw the Aldo fight and, you know, that was quite the roller coaster, and it was very emotional.
Mm.
And, you know, it was like a 1 year process. So, you know, I think McGregor has more options because, let's not forget, he is a champion. You know, there's still the desire, I think, to see him fight Rafael Dos Anjos. Nate has kind of put himself in a corner where he's like, there's nothing else that really interests me right now. And by the way, I'd still, you know, be very much open to the idea of doing the rematch, but doing it at 155 pounds this time, because I think that gives it a little bit of a different spin.
Mm.
So I think McGregor has a lot more options. But the main thing that people need to realize, and trust me, Nate Diaz realizes this as well, this fight means the world to Conor. He has said it. Dana has said it. Everyone has said it. He is almost obsessed with this idea that, you know, he should have beaten Nate, and, you know, he wants to get another crack at him, and he doesn't really want to resume his career until that, you know, second crack happens. So by saying that, you're giving Nate some leverage as well. And because of all the drama that has happened, this might be a big pain in the butt for the UFC, the negotiations back and forth, flying to see Conor, flying to see Nate, you know, the interview here and there, whatever. But make no mistake about it, this fight is a huge deal and a much bigger deal because of what happened, you know, prior to 197 with the retirement and all that. The world is talking about this fight. And how often could we say that about an MMA fight this far out? Like, all this stuff just helps sell the fight, in my opinion. So that's why I feel like it's imperative that they get it done now.
Mm-mm. And we know the lightweight thing was supposed to be a big help to McGregor physically. But in your opinion, with everything that happened between him and the UFC, although their relationship seems to be back on track now, do you think the UFC will still let him be a champion in multiple weight classes in the future? Or do you think Dana and the UFC may be aware that giving McGregor that much power could be a dangerous thing after this whole UFC 200 fiasco?
I think to a degree that remains to be seen, but I certainly think that they recognize his stardom and, you know, the kind of draw that he is. So I do think that they would be open to it. I think that if he doesn't fight Nate next, he should probably fight, you know, in the 145-pound division and defend the title. Because I was okay. You know, the thing that people forget is that 196, while he ended up fighting Nate, was originally supposed to be this champion versus champion fight against Rafael Dos Anjos. So, you know, that all makes sense. And of course, Nate comes in. And then the rematch, people are like, well, come on, you gotta defend the title. And I definitely agree with that. But let's not forget that Conor did the UFC a lot of favors. You know, he took two fights back to back, actually one in July and then one in March, against new opponents, you know, on less than 2 weeks' notice. Didn't, you know, threaten to, you know, pull out of the card, didn't threaten to ask for more money, you know, was really a good soldier. And yeah, there's some, you know, there's negotiations about things along the way, but like for the most part, he was a very good soldier. So I think that the idea that they were going to give him what he wanted in this Nate rematch really, you know, was very valid. And he had earned that right. If the Nate rematch doesn't happen, then I would like to see him, you know, go back and defend that title that he has yet to defend. The tricky part is, Frankie and Aldo are fighting in July, so you'd think that they would need some kind of time off to, you know, recuperate from that fight and get ready for the next fight, which would be gigantic. And now you're talking like you sit Conor on the sidelines till November. I know he doesn't want that. So and of course, you know, Dos Anjos and Alvarez are fighting for the belt that same weekend, so it's the same scenario. So it's a really tricky time, and that's why I think that, again, Nate is the fight that they have to make.
Mm-hmm. Now, Eric, Colin Cowherd mentioned on his podcast, The Herd, that this McGregor versus Mayweather fight is happening in September. You know, then you have Jalen Rose on ESPN say it's happening in 2017. And, you know, even in the Nate Diaz interview, he's talking about how they wanted him and Conor in, August 20th. It seems impossible for McGregor to fight Mayweather considering he's under contract with the UFC. But in your opinion, is there any crazy way that this could even be possible?
Look, there are some people who believe that somewhere, somehow, some crazy way that this could get done. But again, I mean, even Nate saying on my show, like, they went to Stockton to go, you know, finalize that deal. So if this fight was in the works and these people that you mentioned were saying that it was, you know, a done deal and all this stuff, like, then why are they going to offer him the fight? You know, like, someone's clearly not telling the truth there. I think you have to remember two things when hearing these rumors about Floyd Mayweather. First of all, Floyd Mayweather doesn't have a lot of options right now in boxing. He claims to be retired, but I think the whole world knows that he wants that 50-0, at least that 50-0 record. He's currently sitting at 49-0. So Jalen Rose is a buddy from Detroit of Floyd Mayweather's. Floyd Mayweather traditionally fights in September and May. That's where that September date comes from. Floyd Mayweather admitted when this news came out that he was the one that started the rumor. Even Conor, when he sat down with ESPN, he said that, like, no one's approached me about this. And the initial story in The Sun said that he was going to stand to make $7 million while Mayweather was going to make $100 million. That makes no sense. You know, like we all know Conor wouldn't have accepted those terms. So you have to take that all with a grain of salt. You know, Mayweather doesn't have a lot of options, and he's looking amazingly outside of the boxing world to keep his name in the news, and he's you know, trying to bait someone who will take the bait and play with him, because this has been good for Conor as well. And then also, you know, there is something to be said for the fact that Nate is sort of, you know, dragging his feet, and they want to, you know, dangle this carrot in front of him and say, look, if you don't hurry up, we're going to go try to do this fight. Well, I think he gave a pretty eloquent response to that game yesterday when he said that, you know, on Wednesday, when he said that, you know, I'll call your bluff, go take the fight. Again, as I said yesterday, the greatest negotiators are the ones who are 100% prepared to walk away and will not feel any anxiety or guilt over that decision. And that's Nate Diaz right now. He is prepared to sit out and let the game play in front of him. And that's why he's comfortable with playing this game.
Mm-hmm. I mean, Mayweather obviously worked with the WWE on a bunch of events, but do you think there's any way him and Dana White could come to any sort of a deal? Obviously, Mayweather's big on the co-promotion, much like M1 Global with the Fedor back in those Fedor days. Do you think Dana White could budge on an issue like that and let Mayweather co-promote in a fight like that?
Look, I'll never say never, because, again, these are businessmen and they want to make money, and this fight will make money. The only thing, like, I don't. When I get all fired up about this fight, I'm not saying that, you know, at some point this fight can't happen. I mean, this is America, and people, you know, these guys, they want to make money and they recognize that. That being said, what gets me fired up is people saying that it's on. That's the crazy part. It's not on. It's like these are straight lies when people are telling you it's on. Now, will this talk lead to them sitting down? Whatever, but I mean, how many times do we have to hear from the sources themselves? Dana says, hey, Floyd, call me. So what is that? Like, what is he playing a game too? Look at the boxing media. Is the boxing media reporting these stories about September 17th and all that? No, it's people who kind of had connections and want to play the game and help publicly negotiate and all that stuff. So look, Dana and Floyd have had a longstanding relationship. They've known each other for, you know, a couple decades. And, you know, so who's to say? But what are the terms? Is it a boxing match? Would the UFC put Conor? Would Conor agree to be put in that scenario? Would, you know, with the money that Floyd makes, would he want to split some of that with the UFC? And would Conor be okay with how much he makes and how much you know, there's a lot of egos there, and there's a lot of money being thrown around. And I just don't know if those entities could come to terms. But never say never, you know, I never thought James Toney would fight in the UFC, and that happened. So I get, you know, never say never. I'm just saying that right now, anyone who thinks that it's a done deal and is booking flights and hotel rooms in Vegas for September 17th, you know, you're going to have a great weekend there, but you're not going to see that fight.
Yeah, I know. Colin Cowherd's laying it on thick, saying, oh, you book hotel rooms. I hope no one has, you know, in hopes that they're going to see that fight.
I want to see his hotel receipt. I want to see, where's the proof that you did that? I want to see... Show me your Expedia, you know, hotel confirmation or whatever it is. Show me your flight email confirmation. I want to see that. Let's see it. If you're that confident, let's see it.
That's, yeah, you know, I think Colin might have a deal with the hotels, and this is just a sneaky way to make a percentage of everyone who books a room.
maybe.
No, we don't.
Do you guys even know who Colin Cowherd is? Like, is this the first time you've heard of him?
No, we've heard of him before, but we know he's a Fox guy. And when you have things, I appreciate your take that you sort of mentioned yesterday, how, you know, he's a Fox guy, and you got to consider the source of where this is coming from, and it kind of looks like this is a way to sort of, you know, potentially, I guess, negotiate with Nate Diaz and say, hey, there's another fight coming up.
Yeah.
Why? What were you gonna say about Colin Cowherd?
No, I was just, it's just interesting to hear two guys on the other side of the world talk about, you know, because, like, if you would mention, you know, I'm sure there's the equivalent of Colin Cowherd in Australia, I wouldn't know who he is. So it's amazing to me. It just shows, like, the global reach of MMA, because, you know, again, if some sports radio host is talking about Aussie rules football or something, it's not reaching me. But because our sport is not like it's not a national sport, it's very much an international sport. It's just kind of surreal to see people in Australia talk about, you know, he's like an American sports host. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I mean, MMA fans go where the MMA coverage goes, and not that he's an MMA guy, but he's been, you know, it's kind of like, you know, you're obviously on talking. The other side of the world, but here you've got like a big following as well, even though, you know, you're not Australian or anything like that. But anyway. We don't have you long, so we got to quickly wrap this up. A couple of things we want to talk to you about. Other disappointing news this week came in the form of BJ Penn being pulled out of his fight with Carl Miller from UFC 199 due to a USADA IV violation, in which, you know, Penn admitted ignorance, and now we wait to see what kind of punishment the former champion gets. Penn believes it won't be long, and he still wants to fight, but what kind of duration do you think he may end up with, Ariel?
You know, that's the one question that I've yet to get an answer for. You know, one of the big questions was, why did it take so long for this news to come out? You know, he said that he admitted to taking the IV in late March, and now here we are in late May. And what I was explained was that, you know, when you take an IV and don't have a therapeutic use exemption, a TUE, you can then try to get one retroactively, and by doing so, you can go to your doctor and get the proper medical documentation and try to prove that you needed this IV, that you needed the TUE. And then there's a committee that USADA has that, you know, sits and meets and decides whether or not this is a valid reason and that you have the valid documentation. So I was told that that could, you know, USADA, the issue is they don't like to speak on the record about these things. So it's kind of hard to get a lot of answers to these specific questions. But the way I was told, it was like, okay, that could be the reason, which leads me to believe that it probably was the reason. The one thing I don't know is, you know, what kind of punishment is he facing? Because I'm also told that when you do offer up information and you are, you know, willing to cooperate and you're volunteering stuff, that you stand to have perhaps a lesser punishment. But it's unclear at this time, you know, what BJ's facing, whether he's going to keep fighting. All these things are still up in the air, in my opinion.
Mm-hmm. Well, speaking of IVs, we have to ask you your thoughts on the new changes the UFC are looking to make for future weigh-ins. The maximum check-in weight limit at no more than 8% every weight class on fight week. Fighters who come in greater than 8% of their target weight will also be asked to attend weight management, education counseling before the next fight. Fighters will have a window to weigh in beginning at 10 a.m. the day before the event, rather than hitting the scales at the traditional time of 4 p.m., What do you think about these changes, and how much will it affect fighters moving to more natural weight classes, in your opinion?
Well, you know, on the surface, I actually like them very much, and I appreciate the fact that the UFC is looking out for the health and safety of the fighters, because I do believe over the years we've dodged many bullets as far as, you know, health scares when it comes to guys drastically cutting a lot of weight, you know, getting too dehydrated, passing out. I mean, some of the stories that you hear about these guys are just shocking. For example, the one that comes to mind about Chris Weidman before his fight against Damian Maia, UFC on Fox 2 in Chicago, and the fact that he, you know, was lying down in his room and the towels were sticking to him because of the static. He was so dehydrated. I mean, it's just very, and then he has to fight the next day. It's all very jarring stuff. So I like the fact that they're doing this, much like the USADA situation. I like the fact that they're, you know, instituting these rules and trying to do what's best for the sport long term. My issue is that when you institute these policies and rules, along with the Reebok deal, just to name a few, there needs to be a process in which the fighters have some kind of say. So maybe as a collective, the fighters say, you know what, we are okay with this, but maybe we do 10%. You know, maybe that's more feasible, or maybe we do 9%. Maybe that's more feasible. Maybe we do 15%. In other sports, whenever there's radical change, there's a process called collective bargaining. And there needs to be that process. If we are going to institute these radical changes, and make no mistake about it, these are radical changes. These affect, you know, the fighters, you know, more so than anything, and it, you know, changes the way the sport is run. You know, they need to have a say. They need to have a say in the matter. And so, you know, that's my thought. You know, I like it. I like that they're doing it. I like where their head is at. But I wish there was a process in place in which the fighters could, you know, say, you know what, okay, we like this, but we don't like that. Let's meet here. Let's meet in the middle, et cetera, et cetera. Do you get what I'm saying?
No, absolutely. And just finally on that topic, you know, a lot of people sort of worried in regards to McGregor because he has so many issues making his weight cut. Do you think these new changes could potentially mark a quicker finish to his featherweight run than we originally thought?
Man, you know, it's a great question, and only he can truly answer it. But, you know, it's funny. I was looking back at, I think it was UFC Dublin weigh-ins. I don't know why I stumbled upon it, but I just saw a picture of him from those weigh-ins not that long ago, and it's just amazing to see how he looks. I mean, his face, just the sides of his face are, it's actually like, it's uncomfortable to look at. So sunken in. And even, you know, Cyborg, you know, it's like I mentioned this, like this insistence on having her at 140, this fictitious weight class, makes no sense to me whatsoever. It's like, why are we doing this to these fighters? For what reason? But yeah, that's a great point. And you know, maybe it does expedite. You know, he got his belt, he proved his point, he beat Aldo, and then maybe he goes to 155, which is the weight class that he's always said he's more comfortable in, and I think he'd be better suited for that. So yeah, that is definitely something else to consider for sure.
Awesome, guys. Well, make sure to follow Ariel on Twitter at Ariel Helwani and check out the MMA Hour every Monday in the US and every Tuesday here in Australia. Obviously, it's live on YouTube, and afterwards you can check it out on iTunes, Stitcher, SoundCloud, anywhere where podcasts are found. You can, of course, follow all of Ariel's excellent UFC 199 event coverage on MMAfighting.com. Ariel, thank you so much again, mate. It's great to have you on. It's our pleasure having you on.
Hey, guys, my pleasure. I just wanted to say that you guys are doing a tremendous job, and please keep it up because you're great interviewers and you put together great shows on a weekly basis. And I also want to say that I truly love the people of Australia. 127, one of my favorite events ever, reminds me a lot of home. Australia reminds me a lot of Canada. So if there are any Australian fans listening to you, and I'm sure there are many, I just wanted to say thank you for always supporting me and the sport as well.
What's up, fight fans? I'm the reason mixed martial arts is banned in New York, Tommy Tohol. And you're listening to Submission Radio. Let's do this shit!
All right, guys. Our next guest is a multiple-time judo champion, a former Olympian, a former Bellator middleweight champion, and will be taking on Dan Henderson at UFC 199 in a week's time. He is none other than Hector Lombard. Hector, man, it's a pleasure to welcome you back to Submission Radio. How's it going today?
It's going good, mate.
So, Hector, you're going back to your old weight class against Dan Henderson. Talk to us about this move back up to middleweight. You've had a lot of success at welterweight. You were actually undefeated, and your only loss was your last fight to Neil Magny. Why did you decide to move up, back up to 185?
I mean, it never was easy for me to make the weight cut. And my last fight, I really felt I was, now with no IVs and stuff like that, there's no way that you can recover. I mean, it always was brutal, but once you put IVs in your system and stuff like that, you could sort of like recover a bit. And remember when I went for the drug test before the fight, I peed like really yellow, and I was like, dang, I'm in trouble. So, the guy from USADA said, man, you know, you need to drink more water. And I'm like, I've been drinking a lot of water since, but it's like my body doesn't let go. And, you know, it was too hard. And when I was in the fight, I felt dizzy, you know. Remember that when I dropped in the first punch, I'm sort of like took me like a few seconds to find out where he was. And when I find him, you know, that I went kind of like a load my level up. I felt dizzy again. And then in the after the round, I went back to the corner. I was like dead. You know, it's like my body wasn't moving. It's like the workout was terrible. So I had to make a smart decision. You know, I don't want to just kind of like, first of all, I never wanted to be 170, but I had it to do it. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I'm just kind of like, I'm happy now and then back to my old way.
I'm wondering, Hector, you said that you felt dizzy when something about a punch. You felt dizzy when you threw a punch or when you were hit by a punch?
No, when I dropped in the first round.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I landed the first punch,
mm-hmm,
that he went down. It took me like a couple of seconds to find him because, you know, I felt dizzy, you know.
Mm. Wow.
And I did got hit, you know, in the first round, but... when I went back to the corner, I was like dizzy already, you know. And then the second round, I couldn't move, you know. And people said I was gassed. It wasn't that I was gassed, you know. You take a look at the fight, you know, I wasn't even breathing heavy. It's just like my body wasn't functioning.
Mm-hmm.
It's just that I couldn't move. And that happened to a friend of mine, a couple friends of mine, like, you know, when the liver kind of like, you know, doesn't function properly, your body doesn't move, your body kind of like stays stiff, you know, and that's what happened to me. I was just kind of like, I couldn't move, you know. It sucks because, you know, I'm better than that, you know, but I just kind of like, my body just, you know, couldn't move, you know.
Mm-hmm. I'm wondering, if you had beaten Neil Magny in Brisbane, obviously you say you felt dizzy. If you beat Neil, do you think you still would have moved to middleweight? Or you know, did the loss help influence your decision?
Well, the loss made me radical to just say, like, you know, I don't care what any opinion, what, you know, I just don't want to do this way anymore. But I feel that it's funny that you asked me that because I was talking to a friend of mine, you know, before the weigh. It's like I was saying to him, this is not life, eh? Mm. Like, you know, you see everybody having breakfast. I mean, you're not going to have like a big breakfast, but at least sort of like a healthy breakfast.
Mm.
And I couldn't even have that, you know. It's just like miserable the whole freaking time.
Mm.
You know, you just, it's not life. You need to enjoy the sport, you know. Otherwise, I better do something else. And, you know, she's cutting 40 pounds of muscle. You know, I had no fat on me. Like, some people can do it, but they have a lot of fat on it. But I don't have a fat on me, you know. My body's just ripped already. And, you know, I have to cut the water. I have to drink distilled water. You know, can't barely eat. You know, I was just eating vegetables all the time. And I'm like, this is no life, especially at my age, you know. You need to be healthy, man, because sport's not going to be forever.
Mm. So, big, go on, Hector.
Yeah, I just kind of like, I'm happy that I should have done this a long time ago, but when, you know, bad things happen, it helps you realize that you should have done it sooner. But, yeah, you need to do sport, eh?
Yeah, no, certainly. Big breakfasts are the reason why me and Casper could never be MMA fighters. We enjoy them too much.
Exactly.
Now, that's right. So that's why we'll always be interviewing you, but we'll never be fighters. Let's talk about your first middleweight run in the UFC. You went 1-2. Tell us, what makes you think that your second run at 185 will be a more successful one, and what kind of advantages do you expect to have at 185 again?
You put it like 1-2, you know, like I would say 1-2. I didn't lose against Tim Bosch. Everybody knows that.
Mm.
He was running the whole time. He didn't do a thing. The other fight was close. It could go either way. But, I feel that's my way. I mean, 185 is my way. It's always been my way. And, you know, I just don't seem to cut to 170 anymore, to be honest.
Mm-hmm. We actually read, I believe you spoke to MMA Junkie, and you said recently that you might be moving up to light heavyweight as well. Is that true?
Yeah.
Wow.
Between 185 and 205, like that way too.
Just very curious. What is your reasoning behind going to light heavyweight? Will we see you stay at a weight class for a long period of time, or do you anticipate yourself going between weight classes back and forth?
Yeah, I mean, I one reason why I want to go to a 205 is because I want to whoop Tim Bush. You know, I can't live with it without me whoop his ass. You know, and then he can retire. But he is at 205. I want to find the guy, do my. That's one of the reasons. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm a strong guy, man. I'm powerful, and I'm explosive, you know. I don't want to quit, man. I'm done with that. So all my life I've been cutting weight. I'm sick of it.
Yeah. No, we understand. We understand. And I mean, you mentioned Tim Bush, but are there any other names at light heavyweight that you'd be excited to fight in the UFC?
Well, yeah. First of all, I want to whoop that ass. And after that, whatever. I mean, I just want to take a lot of fights this year. Mm-hmm. And that's one. I know the reason why. I want to fight at 185, and I'm happy to be fighting at 185, and you name it. It's because, you know, at 170, I couldn't fight, you know, every 6 months, because, you know, it would have taken me months to get ready, to make my body ready for the fight.
Mm-hmm.
You know, start running, cutting weight, and doing a lot of diet. I mean, it's brutal. So whether I would get injured in between and I would have to stand the fight for another time, or, you know, I would have to wait and see when my body was ready to make the weight cut. Which is like, I want 20 pounds is, you know, a lot easier than 40 pounds, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm, of course. I'm wondering, when was the last time you fought at light heavyweight, Hector? Because you did it at the start of your career. How long has it been since you fought at light heavyweight?
Maybe
10
years.
Wow. Are you concerned at all about the height disadvantage you may have at 205?
Yeah, I mean, like, I had to fight tall guys. Mm. How tall was Monday? Like 6'3", 6'4". Mm.
That's a good point, yeah.
Is that is any lightweight is going to be taller than that?
He's definitely tall, Hector. Now, obviously, a lot of questions about what's going to happen after Dan Henderson. So if you do beat Dan Henderson next weekend, will you be looking to fight Tim Bush after that? Because Tim is fighting Josh Salmon at UFC Fight Night 91, July 13th. If Tim does beat Josh, is that the next fight that you want at light heavyweight?
Yeah. Hopefully, you know, that guy gets injured and I can jump in right away.
Mm. You're going to have to plan some sabotage, make sure Josh Saman doesn't make it to that fight, and then you can jump in there. I'm just wondering, middleweight or light heavyweight, what is your goal? Do you plan on holding the belt in either of these divisions?
I don't know about that. I mean, I actually want to get a lot of fights there. I want to get a lot of fights. I want to keep fighting. I want to get busy this year. You know, back in the days, I could fight like 6-7 times.
Mm.
You know, and that's where I want to be at. You know, I want to be like, you know, always at the office. That's what I like to do, you know, put in that work.
Yeah.
170 stuck me, seeing like for two and a half years, maybe 3 years, you know, I wasn't going nowhere. You know, whether it's like they have to sign a guy to fight me because nobody wants to fight me, or, I never see that before in my life.
Mm. So obviously, with you mentioning middleweight and light heavyweight, I mean, we have to talk about the champions in Luke Rockhold and John Jones. How do you think you would do against those guys, being up at the top of the division?
Well, I know they're yet. Let me win a couple fights.
and we talk after that. So people take me seriously. You know, I want people to take me seriously. She's not want to talk like a joke. So first of all, I'm gonna put this away on Saturday, and I'm gonna do it, and I gotta make it quick, nice and clean, and then after that, you know, hopefully I can get T-Butch and beat that ass quick. After that, you know, you can interview me, and we make another interview.
We'll play matchmakers and we'll talk about that. All right, well, let's talk about your opponent, UFC 199, Dan Henderson. You said recently how he didn't really give you much attention when you first came to America and trained Team Quest. That was many years ago. Have you guys spoken much since? Have you cleared the air with Dan by any chance?
Dan Henderson is just, you know, like a fake. Freaking guy, you know, comes across like a nice guy when he's not. You know, if somebody comes to my training camp, and wants to train, you know, if you one day I have, like, let's suppose that I have a Hector Lombard training camp or Hector Lombard facility, okay? And, you know, some young guys, because, you know, trust me, like, even at ITT, a bunch of guys come from Australia, and I introduce myself, you know, like, hey, man, how are you doing? You know, even guys from New Zealand, you know, like JJ and a bunch of others, you know, young kids, you know, I introduce myself. I tell them, like, you know, whatever you need, if you need a lift, something like that, you know, just give me a call. I change numbers, you know. We talk for a little bit, you know, we roll, you know, we do some training together. Yeah. Not a big deal, eh? This fuck with. It's kind of like, you know, I'm guarding you. So, don't care for me, and I don't care for me either.
I'm just wondering, Hector, what are your thoughts on Dan these days? He's obviously accomplished a lot in the sport. Do you respect what he's been able to achieve?
Well, you know, I will be an idiot, and if I don't respect what he did in the sport, He did a lot. Hey, these guys at the time they had everything in their favor. You know, whether it's like the best facilities, the best training, the best training camp, best training partners, you know, best sponsors and stuff like that. So they start really good. You know, they didn't start like me. Like, you know, working like you know, from, you know, 18 hours a day, and go to the gym and train myself. You know what I mean? Like, that's the hard. You know, they just, you know, they start up, and, you know, he, Randy Couture, and Mandelin, and a bunch of others. They had a good team from the start. I wish I would have had that.
I understand where you're coming from. I'm going to ask you, Hector.
Basically, put it this way. Back in the days, it would have been four big teams, and they were dominating the whole sport. You know, it would be Team Quest. It would be Shooter Box. It would be Brazilian Top Team. And it would be in Japan, where it's like all these Japanese, they exchange the same gym altogether, where Chuto and Bushida, Doyo, they all bouncing around the same gym. So that was the beginning. So from the beginning, he was in the best team. Team Quest. It was a Shooter Box. They had, You know how many people they have back in the days. You know, they're still all together now, but
with a different
name. It's called Kings, anyway. And, you know, the Nogueira and all these people, like, it was called BTT, Brazilian Top Team. So, you know, whoever would be in those teams, you know, they were winning. You know, it was like the level wasn't equal. the level was, you know, like whoever is in those camps are gonna be winning, and the rest, you know, forget about it. Now the level is like, you know, kind of like you're gonna see American top teams, you're gonna see whatever, even like guys training at small teams, they have, you know, people with a lot of knowledge, you know, training them, you know.
Mm.
So now the level is like equal.
I'm wondering, stylistically, you and Dan, I mean, you face fighters in the past, Hector, that you've referred to as blankets because of their wrestling-heavy style. What do you think about his style? And are you excited to be fighting a guy who's had so many exciting fights?
Yeah. I'm excited. I mean, I'm an excited fighter. That's what. So we're both gonna bring it. He's gonna try to knock me out. You know, I know that, and I'm gonna try to knock, you know, KO him too. So it's gonna be fun.
Yeah, certainly. And it'll be a very interesting perspective because obviously you're a fantastic judo grappler and he's also got some wrestling. Both of you are have some great striking. It's going to be very, very exciting. Do you think this fight will go all three rounds?
It's hard to say, but I don't want to. I don't want to make a good impression.
Dan's a guy who said that he's almost ready to retire, and a lot of people see this as almost the end of his road. Do you think that your fight might help him with that decision if it's a dominant finish?
He always saying that, you know. He's always saying the same thing, you know. That's, and I know why he said that. He says that just don't put pressure on himself. You know what I'm saying? Like, he's been saying that since he fought Fedor. He's like, oh, I'm about to retire. You know, facing, you know, a legend like this, blah, blah, blah. He knocked him out, and then he's like, oh, you know, I'm not going anywhere. Then, you know, lose a couple fights, and then he goes like, you know, oh, well, you know, before fighting Tim Bosch, oh, you know, I seen that, blah, blah, blah. KO Tim Bosch is like, oh, yeah, I don't know where, nowhere. I know why he does it.
Why do you think he does it? Why do you think he's saying that?
As I said before, he doesn't put pressure on himself, like, oh, you know, whatever, you know, I'm just about to get a tie anyways.
Mm.
Well, we know that surely you'll want to fight at least one more time because the UFC will be coming to Melbourne in November. Is it safe to say you'll be campaigning to get on that November Melbourne card, Hector?
Yeah. You know, like, definitely, I always want to fight in Australia, but I want to have a couple of wins after that.
Yeah.
When is it? Say it again.
Well, it's probably going to be in November, and they're probably going to be doing it in Rod Laver. I mean, you didn't fight at 193. You didn't get the win in Brisbane. Do you feel like you have to get at least one more win in Australia?
Oh, man. You know, I'm going to have a few more wins in Australia. I can't just leave this sport that way.
Mm-mm.
You know, I'm disappointed, you know, like... And to be honest, I'm disappointed because, you know, my disappointment is because I lost against a guy that I know that I'm better than him, you know? Like, it's just my body didn't function, you know? My body just, you know, gave up on me. I wasn't moving, but, you know, it is what it is. Things happen in the sport, eh?
Yeah, no, for sure. And, I mean, the big fight coming up is against Dan Henderson. So as we let you go, Hector, give us your official prediction. How do you see yourself beating Dan Henderson at UFC 199?
I see myself beating him in a beautiful fashion. You know, I'm going to be fast. I'm going to be explosive. You know, I don't believe that my body's going to be so tired and my body's going to give up on me in this fight. I only have to cut, you know, 15, 20 pounds, you know. So, I mean, that's easy for me. I don't believe that my body's gonna give up on me again. So, you know, I tell you, when I'm at peak, when my body's functioning properly, I will be there like pistol. You will see. I'm not gonna talk anymore because you know it's time to do. But you know, you will see on Saturday. You guys can see on Saturday. And then give me a call after that, eh?
We'll give you a call. We'll give you a call. We'll have a chat about it. We'll organize another interview. Man, we can't wait. It's going to be exciting times. Brand new Hector Lombard back to his old weight class. Hector Lombard Classic, if you will, taking on Dan Henderson next weekend. I believe it's going to be June 4th. And you guys can follow Hector Lombard on Twitter at Hector Lombard. Hector, it's always a pleasure having you on the show, man. Thank you so much for taking the time.
Thank you, guys. And I'll talk to you guys after my fight.
All right, perfect. We'll speak to you then.
Thank you, guys. Bye-bye.
What's up, guys? This is Uriah Faber, the California Kid, and you're listening to Submission Radio.
All right, guys, our next guest is coming off a fantastic performance, arguably the biggest win of his career when he defeated Albert Tumanov at UFC Rotterdam. He is Iceland's own Gunnar Nelson. Gunnar, welcome back to Submission Radio.
Well, thanks for having me.
It's always a pleasure. We really appreciate you taking the time, especially late at night. And before this interview, we were messaging back and forth. You mentioned you were watching Netflix late into the Icelandic night. What are you watching on Netflix, man? Is it more Vikings?
No, it's a movie called 10,000 BC. I don't know if you've seen it. It's pretty cool.
Give us the Gunnar Nelson rating. What do you make of this movie? What is it about?
Well, I'm 40 minutes in, and it's kind of, it's supposedly happens 10,000 BC, and it's just like these little tribes from different places fighting each other, and so it looks like a little love adventure in it as well. It kind of, I don't know if you remember Apocalypto, movie, Mel Gibson movie. It's similar in ways to that, you know?
Well, you don't sound sold on it, Gunnar. I think you're just being nice, just in case the creators of the movie are listening to the show. I assure you they do not, although who knows, maybe they are MMA fans. Now, let's talk about UFC Rotterdam. You got the $50,000 performance of the night bonus. Any ideas on what you're going to spend that money on? Are you the type of guy to splurge and buy more snowmobiles, or you put it away and let it collect interest?
More snowmobile.
How many snowmobiles do you own at the moment, Gunnar?
Nah, I just own one and one really old one, just like an antique almost. But yeah, I'm gonna sell the one I have and buy a new one. So more, like a brand new one.
More guns, more rocket launches on this new one?
Yeah.
We saw some videos of you heading out with snowmobiles, and for those who think that you're a, you know, sort of serious stoic guy, we've never seen so much happiness and emotion out of you as when you're around snowmobiles. Is it safe to say that some of the happiest times in your life have taken place on a snowmobile?
Yeah, I really enjoy riding bikes and snowmobiles. I mean, it's unbelievable, you know. It's so much freedom. And these new snowmobiles, the Polaris Pro RMK, are just, it's ridiculous. Absolutely ridiculous.
Well, what do you guys do? Do you just cruise around the snow? Are you doing jumps and tricks? Are there like little laps that you guys do around the town and you play music while you do it?
we go riding in the mountains. Friend of mine, like, they are really good. They've been riding since they were kids. I'm only new to it, really. Jumps. I don't do big jumps. I just started jumping. They do some serious jumps and just hill climbing. You're just basically traveling over mountains on the thing. And I mean, there's absolutely no limit to how these things can climb. You know, it's just how good you are at riding, you know?
We've seen some crazy snowmobile-related videos on the internet. Any interesting stories you can share from your snowmobile adventures?
A funny one is we took John Kavanagh, my coach, took him out when he was over here. And he's never ridden a snowmobile before, obviously, and he thought he was going to die a few times. And he after, like, just saying that it all came back to him, you know, when he met me, he was like, one day this kid is gonna be the death of me. And that was when he was riding up. It was not a big hill. In his mind, it was the biggest hill, like biggest hill of all hills. And it just became a little bit steeper and steeper, and at the top it was a little bit of a overhang. I don't know if that's the right word, but so it's almost just like vertical. But only like half a meter or a meter. He did well. But he, I could see it in his face when he came up. He thought that this was going to be the end.
John Kavanagh, poetic guy and full circle. Interesting to see his perspective. But, I mean, at this stage, it almost seems like a foregone conclusion that you'll be riding a snowmobile to the Octagon. If me and Casper can organize a Reebok snowmobile for you, would you be open to, you know, cruising down to the Octagon on that baby? Maybe up a wall, down a wall, around the arena a bit, and then to the Octagon.
That would be sick.
I think you'd have to find a new corner, though. John Kavanagh would be like, I can't train you for this one. I'm sorry. All right, let's talk about your recent win in Rotterdam, Gunnar. One of the criticisms of your style, at least, you know, on the feet, has sometimes been that you're a low-volume guy. Against Tumanov, you came out and you really took it to him early on, were very active with lots of pressure. Was that something specific that you'd been working on? And, you know, will you be taking that approach in your future fights?
Yeah, definitely. You know, I have been working on my stand-up, like, specifically for a while. I haven't showcased too much of it, although maybe Brandon Thatz, it was a quick one. And then in the Maya fight, obviously, most of it took place on the ground. And then now was the first time I really felt like I was able to use some of the stuff that I've been using in training. So yeah, it was definitely the plan to come out aggressive and you know, use my tools. I believe I have a lot of tools that I haven't shown yet, you know, and I was able to show some of them in this fight, you know.
Mm-hmm. Well, other than your performance, we saw GQ Gunnar Nelson, because you're in even better shape than you normally are. You seemed more ripped and looked like you packed on some extra muscle. Were you specifically trying to get bigger for this fight, and was it something? Was there something you did differently in training for this one?
Yeah, we started this new fitness program, and what it did to me was just like I was actually lighter than I have been, so the cut was only like it was not even a kilo for me in the bath this time, whereas before it was 2.5, maybe even 3 for the Maya fight, I believe. So I think my body fat versus muscle is like different, you know. The body fat is a lot less than it was. So I think that's the main reason. And maybe some good pictures with a good lighting compared to some of the other ones. But yeah, I think that that'd be the main difference. So maybe I'm like a kilo heavier or like a kilo more muscle and then a couple of kilos less of fat, you know.
Mm-mm-mm. I mean, people have always commented about how you're, you know, undersized at welterweight, and you've always brushed that off and pointed to the extreme weight cutting that, you know, takes place in MMA. I'm wondering if your added muscle or new fitness regime had anything to do with you ever feeling at a strength disadvantage or out-muscled in any of your fights.
No, I never felt that the weight didn't matter too much. Like I've said before, you know, I think it's technique, and you have to, like, of course it does matter to be bigger and stronger, you know, but you have to be able to work around it then. And I'm never going to be a big guy in this division, you know. I'm just like, if I eat whatever every day for 2 months, I won't go higher than 84 kilos. That's the highest I've ever seen on the scales, you know. So I'm not going to be a big welterweight. That's a fact, you know. I can be strong, very strong for my weight. And I can use my speed definitely. I do believe I have a lot of speed advantage too, on a lot of these guys, you know. So I think you should use what you have and learn how to beat the bigger man. In my case, anyway, I'm not going to cut weight and go down to lightweight. I don't like that. I don't believe in these weight cuts, you know, and it's just not my style. So yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, we'll talk about some of the new changes, some of the new exciting changes to weight cuts and weighing in soon, but we have to talk about that finish at Rotterdam. Talk us through it, because it looked more like a crank opposed to a choke. Were you going for a crank instead of a choke? Talk us through what happened when you finished off Tumanov.
Yeah, he kept his chin, you know, low really well. It was hard to get under his chin, and so sometimes you don't really need to get under the chin. You just go over, and then if you're just able to lock if you're able to lock in the rear naked choke, it doesn't matter at all. You know, he's in all kinds of trouble there. He's choking, he's cranking because I'm pulling my shoulder, my right shoulder back, and the elbow. It's just, and it's uncomfortable in every kind of way. But he's also choking because his chin is pushed back so much that it's cutting his air supply.
Mm.
And at that point in the fight, he's going to need some air, you know.
Mm-hmm. It used to be that, you know, when a fighter got their opponent's back, it was pretty much game over. But over the years, obviously, people's choke defense has gotten a lot better. You know, perfect example here, to the point where fighters now are often going for cranks instead of chokes. You know, with some of the recent crank submissions, do you think that's true? And do you think that fighters are moving in that direction more these days, you know, going for the crank instead of the choke as opposed to in the past?
I wouldn't go that way, to be honest. I would just, you know, take what's there. I think chokes are a lot better than cranks still today. I know it's hard to get a clean choke on a good guy, but still I think it's easier to choke a really good guy than to crank him. I think if you're really good, you're always able to kind of move your head in ways that the crank will just kind of... I think you need a lot more force and brutal strength to crank someone than to choke him. You need be a lot more technique and timing and slickness to choke him well if he's good. But I would be more of a believer in choking, you know, cutting the air supply, cutting the blood flowing up to the brain than to crank somebody. Although using cranks to, you know, get chokes as well and mixing it all together is definitely the way, you know.
Mm-mm. Well, one of the interesting things to come out of the post-fight press conference was that not only do you not wrap your hands in fights, but that you would rather no gloves to be worn in MMA. I mean, this is a very interesting point. And a lot of people that are from the boxing background, that sort of blows their mind. Can you explain your reasoning for why you don't want gloves?
Yeah, I mean, I just put it out there. I know that's never going to happen. Mm. You know, I'm well aware of it. But I think a lot of grapplers would agree with me because it's very different grappling with gloves and no gloves, you know. And it's very different, you know, when you're doing something with your hands, you get a feel for it. The feel that you have in your hands is very important. And putting these gloves on just take a lot of that away, you know. So obviously when you train, you need to train with the gloves and get used to the gloves, but it'll never be the same as not wearing gloves, you know. Going in for chokes, for an example, would be a lot better with no gloves, you know. It's a lot easier to slide in all chokes, you know, guillotines, rear naked chokes, every choke you somehow slide in there, you know. Maybe it'd be a little bit easier to get out of some submissions, like arm bars, for an example. I don't know. Yeah, probably. But I think just overall, you get a lot better feel for, you know, because you're working with your hands when you're grappling, when you're fighting, you know. So the better feel you have, the better you can work, you know.
Mm. And just on the whole thing about not wrapping your hands, I mean, from a boxer's mindset, that's a crazy thing because a lot of traditional boxers believe wrapping your hands is so important to protecting your fists, limiting damage when you punch. How do you go about not wrapping your hands? Have you found it to be a lot better for you than wrapping them? And also, do you have to put your hands through specific training to handle not being wrapped? Because I know a lot of people in the gym, if they don't wrap their hands and they go to throw a punch, a lot of the times they'll injure themselves.
Yeah, I mean, I guess that's the con to not wearing gloves or not wrapping, you know, is that you could very well injure your hand and break all these little bones in the hand that they aren't that strong. But then you have to really watch how you hit, you know. You have to train how you hit. And I mean, we used to do quite a bit in karate, you know. They used to teach us how to hit, how the hand was how the hand positioning is supposed to be, where to hit, you know, which knuckles to use primarily. And then they made us hit the board, you know, the makiwara. And you get used to hitting all different types of bags, you know, and hitting all different angles into it. And then slowly you get used to landing punches and getting a feel for where your fist is strong, you know. I think that could help a lot of guys, whereas like boxers just go in day one, put on big gloves, and then just they're taught to keep their hands as loose as possible and just throw your arms out there, you know, only use your hips. And, you know, they're not really taught to punch, I think, you know, as if you were going to punch somebody with a bare hand, because that's very different. So I think I've never injured. Well, I've had bruises in my hands, you know, but that's mainly when I use big gloves. When I'm using like boxing gloves, some of them are not a good make, and I've hit my thumb because it's like you can't make a fist, and it's, you know, the way boxing gloves are, you know, the thumb is kind of up to the side there. You can't make a fist. So I've hit my thumb a few times boxing, but I've never ever hurt my hands with the MMA glove or just no glove. I punch the bag a lot with no gloves, you know, and the small gloves, all different bags, you know, just getting used to it. I think it's just a matter of training, really. Of course, everybody can break their hand, everybody can injure themselves. That's a risk, you know. Well, you see a lot of guys breaking their hands even though they're wrapped, you know. I think there's other things in there than, you know, I don't think you can just wrap your hands and you're safe. I think there's other things that might matter more than these little wraps, you know.
That's fascinating. I'm wondering, are there any other rules that you would like to see change, Gunnar? I mean, we know your thoughts on extreme weight cutting in MMA. We'll talk about that in a second, but are there any other rules that you would like to see added or taken away?
No, mainly the weight cutting would be my main thing. The gloves, it's not really a thing that matters too much to me. I know if you take out the gloves, you probably see so many more fight stops because of cuts, and I don't really want that. So I do believe that we need gloves, you know. I just threw that out there. You know, it was just like I'm making a little point, you know. Didn't really mean too much with it, you know. Although I still stand by what I just said, you know. I think it will be more realistic and it's great for a grappler, you know. Really good.
Well, they're all fascinating points. Sorry, go on, Gunnar.
Yeah, no. So the main thing that I would like to have changed would be weight cutting. But one more thing that would really change the fight and make it more realistic is take out rounds and let the fight be, because one thing we've seen over and over again is somebody is in a really bad position and then the round is over and then they start and then again. That's not a nature of the fight, you know. That's nature of show business, and I understand it, you know, but it's not the nature of the fight, and that fight could have very well be over, you know. You could say the same on the feet sometimes. Somebody's running away, you know, he's tagged, he's rocked, and then he gets a minute break, brings him back in, you know. It's not the nature of the fight, but it's show business. It's what it is, you know.
Well, it's all fascinating points, and actually a lot of people speaking on that point as well, the round system, not always popular with a lot of fans. Now, speaking of weight cutting, it seems like the UFC has been listening and will be implementing a new rule beginning at UFC 200, where fighters must check in at the start of the week at no more than 8% of their target weight. If they're over 8%, they'll be monitored daily, and if they show signs of dehydration, they'll be pulled from the fight. I mean, this must be music to your ears, Gunnar. You've spoken to us many a time about this. What are your thoughts? And are you happy to finally see measures like this?
Yeah, I mean, this is great. Did you say that they were discussing this, like the UFC?
No,
were?
It's going to be implemented from UFC 200.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow, I hadn't heard this.
So are you just learning about this from us now?
Yeah.
Well, how about that? I mean, look, that's kind of a full circle thing. If John Kavanagh was here, he'd say this thing started in a lot of ways on Submission Radio. You're talking about how it should be changed. And now, look at this. It's changed, and we are the ones to tell you about it. Yeah, man, this is going to be happening from UFC 200. There's also going to be earlier weigh-ins. Instead of the 4 p.m. weigh-ins, people are going to have an opportunity to weigh in from 10 a.m. How about that?
Yeah, this is perfect. This is where we want it, you know. This is towards the right direction. I had to look this up and and read more about it now. But this is awesome. I didn't even know. It's crazy that I'm hearing it from you guys now.
you must be happy about this, because this is something that you've wanted for a long time, you know, to sort of get rid of these extreme weight cuts. And I mean, it may not get rid of it 100%, but like, what kind of changes do you think that's going to mean for your division, specifically the guys that you're going to be fighting in the future?
I mean, yeah, they must have some guys move up from this. So how does it go exactly? So you have to say it again, like the rules basically.
So at the start of fight week, you can't be more than 8% over your weight limit. So yeah. I don't have it in front of me, like a welterweight. I'm not sure what you'd be weighing, but I think it's around 182, 183, something like that. And if you're over, then I guess you're going to be monitored, and they're going to be making sure that you're not dehydrated or you're not dehydrating yourself, which would, in theory, stop people from doing a weight cut at the start of the fight week. And then if you know, over that next 7 days, week, they see that you are really dehydrated, you may be pulled from the fight.
So only if you are over, you're monitored, is it?
So if you come in and you're over 8%, you're not going to be pulled. Yeah. But if they see over the next week that you are really dehydrated, then you will be pulled from the fight, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, this is going to force a lot of guys to go up, I believe. So it's going to force people to fight people their own weight. I really hope they do monitor, and I don't know how they do that, but it would be very bad to see guys still forcing themselves to do a nasty cut and just come in, you know, maybe that 8%, but they've already cut. So they need to monitor these guys as well that come in and are, you know, already under 8%, you know, because they might be... They might be cutting before, and they might be already drained, and I don't know. Maybe a few guys are gonna do that, and then realize that's just way too much, you know, and then it's gonna take it all out of you for the fight. But you know, I think they should monitor everyone, see if people, any of us, are too dehydrated, or you know, not fit to fight, basically, not fit to perform, I think, in some of these cases. You know, there's, like we've talked about before, this guy's been dropping down doing that weight cut, and they've done it a few times before, but all of a sudden they drop down. So it's, you know, it speaks for itself. It's very bad for you.
Well, your father and yourself have obviously been very, very vocal about all of this. And who knows? I mean, there's a big possibility that the UFC listened to what you guys had to say, and you were a big part of this rule change. I'm just wondering, after this is all said and done, and you call up your dad and presumably talk about these changes, what will you say to him? I mean, in a lot of ways, is this a bit of a victory for you guys?
Yeah, definitely. He definitely doesn't know about this, because otherwise he would have been on the phone to me. Like,
now you get to break it to him. Isn't that cool? We get to break it to you. You get to break it to him. What are you going to say? What are the first things you're going to tell him? And you, by the way, you have to mention Submission Radio. You can't take this away from us. Submission Radio told
him. Yeah. Yeah, I'll ring him and say, we've done it. I'll definitely, I'll call him right after this. I know he'll be awake. He's a... he's a night bird, you know.
Yeah. He's a night owl, old Hallie. Now, going back to you, Gunnar, you came off that loss to Damian Maia that you told us broke your heart a little bit, and now you come back to dominate, beat, and finish a guy that was supposed to be, you know, the next big thing at welterweight. What does this win do for your confidence?
It was a great win for me. You know, it does a lot for me because, especially like I said before, I got to try out a lot of things that I've been working on, and I got to show a lot of my tools, you know, and as well coming off that loss, feeling not too great about my performance and my physique, coming into this fight just, you know, performing like this and feeling the way I felt and connecting really well with my body, and it meant everything to me.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm not sure if you've had a chance to have a look at the rankings, but as far as what's next for you, is there any name that stands out or gets you excited?
Not really. Like always, you know, I just want to fight the next guy, you know, and as I've said before, I believe I'm going to fight most of them, if not all of them, you know. So who's next is not really my focus. I'm focusing on my training, and obviously want to get a guy that's ranked higher than me, preferably. But my nature really isn't even thinking about the rankings, you know. I would be kind of really forcing myself to be like, yeah, so, you know, this guy's ranked there and this would make sense, and, you know, climb up the ladder and yada yada yada, but it wouldn't really be my nature. But yeah, you know, it would make sense for everything to get a guy that's ranked, you know, at least maybe the top 15, top 10, top 5 would be great, you know, anyone.
I definitely agree that, yeah, for sure, a big step up in competition, hopefully one that will, you know, put you on the map even more on the way to a title shot. But we do want to get your thoughts on the landscape of the division. You know, when we spoke to you last, you mentioned how you thought Damian Maia should get the next title shot. A lot of people are discussing this. What did you think of his performance at UFC 198, and do you still think he should be next in line?
Yeah, I would like to see him fight for the title, you know. I think his performance against Brown was great. I believe Brown went to decision with Lawler, if I'm right. He finished him in the third round. I think he's done a lot to prove that he's next in line, you know. Even though he lost to McDonald, I still think that he showed some great moments in that fight as well. And I think he would probably be next in line, you know.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, a fellow karate alum in Wonderboy Thompson is fighting Rory McDonald. Do you think Maia gets a title shot over the winner of that? And also, speaking of title shots, what do you think about Tyron Woodley getting the shot against Robbie Lawler? Do you think he's the right guy to get that shot?
Yeah, that kind of surprised me, but I feel like I haven't seen Tyron Woodley for a while, but I don't see all the fights, you know. It did surprise me a little bit, but he's a great fighter, you know. I think Wonderboy, if he beats McDonald, it would be hard to not give him the title shot. And I think that that would be a fight that people would see as a very exciting fight. Two strikers, but very different styles. People would be very excited to see that matchup. So I think if Wonderboy does beat Rory, he will get the title shot.
Sorry, go on.
If Robbie is still a champion, that is. I don't know if Woodley beats him, then maybe it's a little bit different, but still, Wonderboy is undefeated, right?
No. Matt Brown beat him. Matt Brown beat him when he came to the UFC. I'm not that familiar with his record, so I don't know if he's been beaten any other times, but I know Matt Brown beat him. But you mentioned if Robbie Lawler is still the champion, I know you said you haven't seen too much of Tyron's fights, but what do you think? Do you think he can get it done? Do you think he is the man to beat Robbie Lawler?
Woodley,
yeah.
No, I don't think so.
Why is that? Take us into your mind. You've obviously got a great mind for these things, and you spend a lot of time watching these fights. Why do you think he may not be able to get it done?
I don't think he's durable enough for Robbie. I think Robbie has a lot more fight in him for longer. You know, I think Woodley is a great athlete. I think he punches a little bit too. He's a low volume as well, like you were talking about that. That I have, and I think his just his style, the way he's low volume, he's very strong and powerful, and I think whatever he's going to throw at Robbie, he's going to be able to defend and just kind of wear him down if he doesn't catch him early. That's how I see the fight go, you know. That's basically, I think their energies is going to kind of match like that, you know. I think either Robbie will catch him or, you know, Woodley might get one takedown early. I think Robbie will scramble up and slowly wear him down and probably finish him, you know.
Mm. Now, let's get back to you, Gunnar. I mean, a big win under your belt, a lot more confidence. GQ Gunnar Nelson in shape, lots of muscle, whether it's under the right light or not. What kind of timeline are you looking to get back in the octagon? Do you have a certain event in mind where you'd like to return?
Yeah, I'd like to return this fall, you know. This summer is going to be, I'm going to spend a lot of time with my boy now. His mom is going to go abroad. She's doing like some project in Berlin. So I will be spending a lot of time with him this summer. So, you know, I'd like maybe this fall, you know. I don't know exactly what cards are on, but I would be aiming for a little summer vacation or spend some time here. I'm always training, but...
I was going to say, what month is that? You say fall, but we got different seasons. What month is that?
So maybe September, October.
Okay.
Maybe.
Very interesting. Well, Gunnar, look, we'll let you go. We know you're tired. It's late over there. Before we let you go, one last thing. What are these rumors of your boy Conor McGregor possibly fighting Floyd Mayweather that we keep hearing about? What do you think about this? Do you think it happens, or is this all just pure speculation?
I don't know. They're definitely hyping it up.
Yeah,
both of them.
Yeah.
Mm. You know, both of them are taking part in it. So I think they would definitely like to build it up, build up the money, and make it happen at some point. But I don't know how it works with UFC and like, and the contract. They have to, they had to make some deal with them and include them somehow, because yeah, we, most of us know how the UFC deals are, and you can't really just go off and do a super fight with Floyd Mayweather if you're signed with the UFC.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, we'll see how things go. I definitely don't think it's gonna happen. Or whenever they said, what, September or something?
Yeah, yeah. I think that's pretty much a write off. I don't think anybody thinks it's gonna happen in September. But
I don't think New Year's. I think that's a bit too close, and I think they're, you know, just putting dates and stuff like that, it will just hype the whole thing and just keep hyping it until they'll get few 100 million or whatever, you know?
Yeah, well, hopefully, maybe, if the stars align, maybe, and if it's supposed to happen, we'll see it. But in the meantime, Gunnar, hopefully we'll see you back, obviously, after your nice trip to Berlin. Hopefully we'll see you around that September time frame. We really appreciate you taking the time, guys. Don't forget to follow Gunnar on Twitter, at Gunny Nelson, and, of course, on Instagram as well. And check out his gym as well, you know, Mjolnir MMA. How am I doing with pronunciation? Did I get it, Gunnar, or did I butcher it?
Yeah, that was pretty good, actually.
Mjolnir MMA? All right, there you go. They are super, super busy and active on Instagram. So check that out as well. And again, we'll let you get back to your movie, 10,000 BC. And thank you so much for chatting with us, Gunnar.
Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot, guys.
Hey, this is Ariel Helwani, and you're listening to Submission Radio with my two favorite mates, Dennis and Casper.
All right, guys, on the heels of UFC Fight Night 88, we have a very special guest joining us to help us break down his thoughts on the event. You know him as one of the best analysts in the world of MMA. He returns to our program now. Robin Black, welcome back to Submission Radio. Thanks for joining us.
Hey, guys. Thanks. Thanks for having me.
This has been a long time coming, and since the last time you've been on the show, fans have been hitting us, but obviously, you know, get Robin Black on the show. So, without further ado, let's get straight into it. You know, big night of fights, a really, really stacked card. The first one I want to talk to you about is Brian Caraway defeating Aljamain Sterling. Aljamain being, obviously, a huge prospect, just recently signing that big deal with the UFC. A lot of people expecting him to potentially go all the way. You know, he faltered. What did you make of this fight? Give us your thoughts, Robin.
You know, going into this one, people were, you know, Caraway was some astronomical underdog. And I was looking at it thinking, you know, this one to me was about who was mentally in this fight. Caraway at different times in his life has seemed kind of not quite there, you know, hesitant, tentative. He's talked about being overwhelmed with the moment. But when he's on, you know, and he's very, very skilled. And Sterling has felt to me like one of these guys who kind of needs a loss to kind of turn that corner and just kind of let go of the steering wheel a little bit. And this is what he needed. This is exactly what he needed. He needed to go in there and kind of lose because of a few holes in his game that are there. You know, Caraway said that he thought he was afraid to get punched. And, you know, he fights like it. You know, he really does. He's either all the way out or all the way in. But when you're all the way out kicking at distance and you're just not setting those kicks up, they're hard to land. And all the way in, you've got to go through that area where you exchange with your hands. And that's the area he's kind of tentative about. Caraway was right. You know, I think Sterling's a killer fighter. I think a loss. And I'll say the same thing about the main event. There are points where these young guys need a loss. You know, these older veterans who are adding the new elements to the game, they have such stable games, such stable, well-developed games, and then they add these new modern elements. And some of these younger guys are learning the modern elements without the full stability, the full, complete game. So I think it's important. I think there's a good loss for Sterling. I think it's a really good loss at a really good time for him.
Mm-hmm. Now, you mentioned, obviously, the strength and the mental game of Caraway, but like he said, he doesn't like to be punched. His attack is pretty predictable. He's a great grappler, but in the striking department, there are some improvements that need to be made. I mean, this is a huge win for him, but what kind of changes would you like to see, or improvements to his game would you like to see if he was to fight for the title in the future?
Well, I kind of feel like we saw some here. You know, Caraway, Sterling fought the fight the way Caraway used to fight, you know? All the way out, you know, trying not to get hit, trying not to get tangled into something. And then when you get the chance, get in and try to get on top. That's the way Caraway used to fight. That's how Sterling fought. So it feels like Caraway has already turned that corner a little bit. He was the guy trying to push it into man up range, you know. And so that was good, I think. I think he looked really, really good. I mean, he's been around for a long time. There's something not quite likable about his personality. And I don't know if it's just because we all think his girlfriend is so hot. Like, I don't know if that's what it is. But, you almost get the feeling a guy like this is going to have more, because we all know that personality and audience, that the audience opinion and all that kind of stuff that shouldn't matter in a pure sport does matter. Mm. You almost wish that this guy would just embrace it and give everybody the finger and say, yeah, that's right, I'm taking this bitch home tonight, you know, like, and play it right, play it right. Yeah, up. Yeah. it's almost like that's the way this guy's going to get paid and fight for a title, is embrace the fact that people hate him. Because game-wise, he's got that solid game that's going to be tough. He's one of these weird guys who can beat anybody on any given night. And you almost hate those guys. If you're a top five guy, you're like, well, I should be able to beat Brian Caraway. But if he's on his game, if he has his head together and he puts it together just right, he's a tough guy to beat.
I agree with you on this one. And even though I did have Sterling winning, obviously before the fight, I thought Sterling would pull it off. I thought if he's going to win, it's going to be a really hard-fought battle. This wasn't by any means an easy fight on paper. But what's crazy is that Aljamain Sterling, you know, up until now, he's been ranked number 4, Brian Caraway number 8. So there's a big switch in obviously, there's going to be one in the rankings. And also, to your point, I think Caraway needs to either be the Stone Cold Steve Austin of the division or the New Age Josh Koscheck. But I want to get your thoughts on the actual the scorecards, because, you know, you had one judge going one way, you had the other judge going the other way. I personally had this fight scored a draw. What about yourself?
Yeah, you know, I was feeling that too. I don't always score. Like, somebody was asking me about the score of, I think it was Felder Berkman, and I was like, or Story Safadine. I'm like, I was just enjoying them so much that sometimes I don't get the full score. You know, I don't look at it from that perspective. But in this one, I thought Sterling easily could have been a 10-8 in round one. Mm. And then I don't know which judge gave him another round, or judge gave him a 10-8, gave Caraway a 10-9, and then gave them a 9-9 or something. I don't know. I don't know how they got a split decision with Sterling winning, you know, on a card, because I had him get 10-8 in the first and Caraway 10-9 in the next two.
Mm-hmm. Well, moving up the card, Sarah McMahon defeated Jessica I. Now, both girls going into this fight with 2 losses each. So a very important fight, and both were once up the top of the division, or going up the top of the division with a big talk. It was impressive what Sarah was able to do, Jessica. What was your thoughts on the fight, and what did you think I did wrong by letting McMahon dominate her so much in the grappling?
When you said, what was my thoughts about what I did wrong, I was like, you, what did you do? It's like, oh, right, Jessica. what did you do wrong? Well, you were,
we did a lot wrong, but we can't break that down on
podcast.
That's a whole different deal. Yeah, you know, Sarah McMahon, Brian Stan nailed it, and Brian Stan's become a very, very good color commentator, man. He's right on top of it. And he nailed it. And right after, Sarah said the same thing. It's like, you know, they both knew each other's tendencies so much, but that's a tough fight to kind of try to win when Sarah was – and the one place I differed with him was in round one. He was like, Jessica I's being tentative. To me, it was Sarah McMahon being tentative. She would, like, take a little step forward, and then it would look like she was stressed right away. Like, she would test it, tease it, pop her toe in it, and then stress out and back out. But she did enough to win that, you know, that round, and the second round got a little better for her, and the third round got a little better for her. I mean, if you're going to be there for 15 minutes with somebody who can wrestle like that, you're going to end up on your back. You have to – these are fucking tough fights to fight. And even ones where you get into the third round against a super killer wrestler, and you'll hear people say, oh, they got to go for broke. Well, if you go for broke, you'll push forward throwing punches. If you push forward throwing punches, the wrestler will lower the level of their hips and chest all the way down and drive into your hips, and you'll be on your ass. So it's like you're kind of damned if you do and you're damned if you don't. That's why a Sarah McMahon fighting this way, you know, it's not going to make her the most fans in the universe, but that's not all that important if you keep winning. And if she keeps fighting this way, it's really hard to beat somebody like her when you know that if you get within an arm's reach and a half, she can take you down. Mm. So I think that was a great fight for her. I think, you know, personally, the women's division still are developing, and it's kind of an undeniable aspect that through the development of fighting, you see these real pockets where you can kind of compare. Like Ronda Rousey is kind of Vice Gracie. Sure, it was judo instead of jiu-jitsu, but she knew something everybody didn't. And for the first, you know, number of fights of hers, she could take you down and armbar you. You couldn't stop her. She had a skill you didn't have. Jonathan Jacek is Chuck Liddell. You know, she stops your takedown, she punches you right in the face. Mm. And so there's that sort of still, that's still very one skill centric kind of fighting. And when you've got Holly Holm being the killer boxer, and when you've got Misha Tate being the great grappler, and you got Ronda Rousey being the slick judo player, I want the slick wrestler in there. So it makes sense, you know, that she's still kind of in that mix and match game.
Makes a lot of sense. And there's quite a few fights to talk to you about, but I just want to take a really quick detour. Lorenz Larkin versus Jorge Masvidal. Just want to get your thoughts. Do you think the right man got their hand raised? I mean, this is another fight where I'd forgive you for not really keeping track because it was an amazing fight. So I just want to get your thoughts on that one. And just in general, what you think of Lorenz Larkin's, you know, late career resurgence at welterweight?
This is one where I didn't really pay attention to the scoring that much on number one. And number two, I'm super biased because, like, Jorge Masvidal is literally one of my five favorite fighters in the world to watch. Mm. Like, he's just so smooth. Like, you know, I made a Jorge Masvidal versus Raging Al Iaquinta drinking game when they fought. And every time Jorge Masvidal became super fluid, because he is super fluid, every time you saw him become super fluid, you had to take a drink of your super fluid. He's just so smooth and just like he flows between things so well. He's such a pure fighter. So I'm such a fan of his. But at the same time, even with that in mind, I kind of feel like Larkin, it felt to me, kind of took away those first two rounds. But Larkin, man, I didn't expect that. Here's one. I can sit there going, we kept saying Caraway. It was crazy that people were counting him out. And I did think Jeremy Stevens was going to beat Barao. And I was pretty confident Garbrandt was going to win. So there's these ones where you can sit there and talk like you're some, you know, everything. But this one, I didn't see Larkin being able to at all sort of handle that smooth flow of Masvidal, especially just kind of standing in range like that. And it was really impressive of him to do so. And I'm not going to underestimate him again. He's somebody that, and he's fun to watch, you know. Mm-hmm. He's super athletic, but he's also got cool timing and he's got a good head. You know, his mind is good. He's fearless. Like he's looking really good. And it's somebody who covers mainstream sports can just look on Sherdog or Tapology or whatever and see that he beat the welterweight champion of the world, and that kind of writes itself. So I'm not going to underestimate that guy again. He beat one of my very favorites.
Mm-hmm. And just quickly, with the eye poke, do you think a point should have been deducted?
That's a tough one. Mm. You know, like on one hand, the eye poke, the fence grab, you know, these ones, we've seen this, like, do we each need a warning or have the 700,000 warnings we've seen in other fights? Is that enough? You know what I mean? Do we need a warning to each guy in each fight on each night, or do we get it by now? You know, so there's an argument, and plenty of people make it, and they have a good point. If we all knew that with one eye poke and one fence grab, we would lose a point, I'll bet you would see about 5 to 10% as many as you see now, which means they can control it if they were penalized, which means it shouldn't be happening. So there's definitely an argument for that. But as it stands right now with the rules the way they are, no. And he certainly, it seemed like an accident. He made a point to say it's the first eye poke that he's ever committed in his fighting career. And I'm sure there are guys even nerdier than you and I that are combing to see if that's true right now. So I think in his case, no. But there's definitely a good argument for just make it an automatic point.
Well, speaking of the welterweight division, Rick Story defeated Tarek Saffiedin. I mean, Story out for such a long time, comes back and looks fantastic. What did you make of his return performance?
We were talking to Rick Story at Fight Network this week, and I asked him kind of a dumb question. He didn't think it was a dumb question, but it kind of was. I'm like, you know, I put him in a category with Matt Brown, where like a big part of their game, like some guys build their games around wrestling. These days, people aren't so compartmentalized, but you know, even 5 years ago, some guy builds his game around wrestling, another guy builds it around Muay Thai. These guys just build it around being a tougher son of a bitch than everybody else, you know? And he was like, oh, absolutely, no doubt. Oh, that is totally true. So he didn't think it was a dumb question. But it kind of is, but it's sort of true. It's like when you start with the raw materials of just a better man, a tougher, mentally tougher, more rugged man, that's a nice place to start building a fighter. you know? And that's kind of Rick Story, and that's kind of Matt Brown, and there's others like that. You know, there's elements of that in Jeremy Stevens too, where it's just, you know, if you're the toughest guy in a giant room full of the toughest guys, well, let's let you fight with that as an attribute. And that's what Rick Story does. He's like, he's going to wade into things. He's going to, because he's so committed, that he'll take two of yours if he can land three. And even if he lands one, he's pretty sure it'll be good. That just raw material is a big part of who he is. And I've always liked watching Rick Story fight. He looks a little different. Like on first glance, if you watched 10 Rick Story fights and 10, or let's say 3 Rick Story fights and 3 Tarek Saffiedine fights, and you fought a bit, somebody said, which guy would you rather fight? You would totally on first glance rather fight Rick Story. But I don't think that would be a good idea. He's going to fuck you up. Like, he's going to hurt you. I like watching him fight. I like watching him fight because of that. And it beat skill this time, you know? Guts and heart and ruggedness beat technical skill this time. And it's a beautiful thing to see. It can still be done.
I agree. And Tarek Saffiedine, I mean, he's a really tough fighter. It's just, you know, he's not really looking like the same guy that he used to be. But I'm going to move on to the next fight. You're talking about tough guys. Jeremy Stevens. Were you going to add to that, Robin?
No, I like that transition. The one thought I did have is, like, Saffiedine, it seems like he's thinking more now. Like, when he beat Nate Marquardt, and, you know, when he's looked his best, he didn't look like he was thinking. And now he does look a little bit like he's thinking. He's a brilliant fighter. I love the kicks on the exit when they would go to separate and he would throw the head kick. It was funny. I've never seen – it also might be a function of Rick Story just being so different and having such different rhythm and stuff. But Tarek Saffiedine's – none of his kicks landed super clean. I'll have to go back and watch, and I'm sure that is more of a credit to Rick Story than it is any flaw in Saffiedine.
Right. Well, I was going to say, I love the kicks on the exit when he exited the clinch, but I also, probably even more so, I love the way Rick Story just took him. Now, back to that sweet, sweet transition that you mentioned. Speaking of tough guys, Jeremy Stevens beat the also tough Henan Barao. I mean, what did you think of this one? Because people were saying that 145 was going to be Barao saving grace. I mean, this guy's had a string of bad luck, lost the title, lost the rematch, out for, you know, a long time. Things just weren't going his way, and now he comes in and loses. But it was a great fight. What did you think of this one, Robin?
Yeah, it was super fun. That was a cool fight. And I think the biggest takeaway, or like one of the broad stroke takeaways I'm going to take from it, is that I actually figured Henan Barao, the abuse that he had taken for 45 plus minutes from TJ Dillashaw. There was a fight with Mitch, my buddy Mitch Gagnon, in between, but who is a killer. But the 45, 47 minutes of abuse he took, I thought, I don't know if he's going to be able to handle this kind of heat anymore. And to see him handle, you know, the abuse in round two and still back, that was impressive. He's not done. That, I mean, to see that tells you he's not done. But we were, again, credit to Stan. I always have, but I really enjoy what he does on the mic. And he pointed out that Barao was very light in round one. And if you looked at it, Barao was stepping and pivoting. He was moving his head. He was coming in on different angles. He was timing different things. And a lot of times when guys will get beat up by somebody who makes them feel amateurish, and that's what TJ did to him, they'll go back, and the experience of having something beat you so badly, you want to do that to other people. You're like, well, I was the champion of the world for so long, and yet along comes this other stage of growth that somebody lays on me, and it was so frustrating. What if I could do that to other people? So he was starting to do that a little bit. And then he went for all those takedowns. I think he was 0-9 at one point. And I think it was shooting all those takedowns tired him and made him. So in the gym, you're boxing, you're kickboxing, you're playing, and you're light on your feet, and you do 5 rounds like that. There's no problem. But now you do 9 hard, failed takedowns against Jeremy Stevens, and he hits you a bit and you get tired. You're not light on your feet anymore. Mm. And that's when it happened. It was the combination between the sort of the new approach, the new striking approach. I don't think it had been, well, it hadn't been tested in real time, in battle, combined with the fatigue of wrestling. And I think that was the difference. And then Stevens just got better and better as the fight went on. If you're not a Jeremy Stevens fan, I don't know why you watch fighting. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yeah, he's like, got a very special place in MMA. And just quickly on him, I mean, he's not going to be fighting for the title next, but fans love to watch him. What do you think his place in MMA is right now? Because with titles not being as important to a lot of people and all these super fights, there is a very real possibility he could co-main event fight nights and just not go for the title, but just have exciting fights for the remainder of his career.
Yeah, I agree with you. I'm just glancing on the internet, and UFC 71 in 2007 was when he first fought in there. So, I mean, at this point, I'm guessing, but he must make $60,000 or $70,000 to show, $50,000 for sure. So, $50,000 to show and $50,000 to win. He might get, you know, they might have got fight of the night too. So, if he's taking $150,000 home and he can do that three times a year, Jeremy Stephens is doing pretty good. The thing with titles is, truthfully, throughout history, titles have always been a construct. They're a construct so that to give us context. They're a construct because following them in and of itself interesting. It's almost its own thing, the way people play fantasy sports while watching football. It's like a separate thing. They let us, if we like lists and ordering things, they let us order fighters and follow their path up, project things. Well, who's going to fight next? What if it's this guy versus this? And that kind of anticipating is fun. All of that is legit. The reason that titles feel a little less, that construct of the title feels a little less important now, is we don't notice how ritualistic certain things in our culture is. Like when we turn on the TV, and I work for a fight television channel. So 24 hours a day, we're running fighting. And I work with very talented people, very smart people, very good producers. But in the context of, say, a month, we'll do at least four preview shows for four things. We'll do, you know, a new show every day. We'll do, you know, et cetera, et cetera. So I'm going to say 50 times a month, either the conversation or a tease or a television commercial will be like, and so-and-so, if they win, they'll get a title shot. And they use even the same term, title shot. And will they be able to face for the title? And now there's eight titles, and there's a couple interim titles. In boxing, there's hundreds of titles. Once there's hundreds of titles and thousands of people selling the moment where this guy will get a title shot, when you put it in that context, it all loses its value. It just, I mean, is it the 40th time in 3 years or the 140th time in 6 years when you hear the winner of this will get the title shot? At what point does it devalue that construct? Now, if and when that happens, you can either create something else to make it more exciting, or then you go to selling the Twitter beefs, or you go to selling, oh, these guys really hate each other this time. And then when does that tire off? At 100, at 200, at 300, when guys, oh, so much emotion in this fight, and the winner will get a title shot. Well, I've seen that thousands of times, and it doesn't have the same value as the first dozen times, which is why, to me, we have to get to the point where we see the beauty of the combat itself. It's easy to sell, you know, this is a rematch between two guys who hate each other, and the winner will fight for the title. We can sell that. It's easy at first, but over time, like so many things in our culture, it loses its value. So that's why I think it's so important to dig and analyze and show and explore the, because at its root, when people fight, it is mind-blowing. It's, you know, we'll often say, and I freaked out a few weeks ago, I was like, there's so many people, and I would like had a freak out about analysis, the quote analysis. I love analysis. I love, there's dozens of analysts I love. Mm-hmm. But you'll see people say, post-fight analysis, and then you'll click on it. It'll say, it's kind of a lackluster fight tonight, you know, a bunch of decisions, but that's not analysis. Telling me whether or not you enjoyed the fights and is not analysis. Analysis is looking into the complex details of what happened as we all kind of learn about it. Anyways, I'm going off on a crazy tangent, as I'm often prone to do, and I'm not high. I'm just going on a crazy tangent. But I have no idea how we got on that tangent. Oh, titles. Yeah. So because they are somewhat less – they have less value than they might have 5, 10, 15, 20 years ago, 40 years ago in other combat sports. because of that, I think guys like Jeremy Stevens, where what if the title itself is less of a premium and has less value, what does? Well, currently, what does is excitement and personality, right? Mm-hmm. Excitement and personality. And what does Jeremy Stevens have? He's got excitement and personality. I think the next level, and still also, you know, we'll call it trash talk, but promotion, excitement, personality, and promotion. Those things have almost eclipsed the idea of the title. I think if the logical expression further is we go to pure skill and talent. But that's a lot of work from a lot of people to take the audience there. And we'll see if we get there, if the audience gets there in 3 years or 5 years. But currently, yeah, Jeremy Stevens, sorry to go off on a crazy tangent. Currently, Jeremy Stevens, exciting. And has lots of personality. So I think people will love him. And I think, yeah, you can use him as a co-main. You can main event him against the right guy on a fight night. If Conor McGregor loses again, of course he's got to fight Jeremy Stevens, you know?
Mm. And to your point, Conor McGregor was, you know, a huge personality in a, I don't know if I'd say draw, but, you know, there was a lot of interest in him before he ever won a title. And, hey, Nate Diaz, he's pretty popular these days, and he's not a champion, and who knows if he ever will be. Now, moving on to the main event, Cody Garbrandt beat Thomas Almeida. You know, the odds were pretty close on this one, but they did have Almeida as the favorite. And we saw your breakdown on that TV network that you say is called, obviously, the Fight Network, for anyone who's been living under the rock. And you're talking about skill versus will. You know, both these guys are like unstoppable forces. They both expect to win, but who's going to have the skill to, you know, to obviously do it and get the job done? Garbrandt did it. What did you make of this one, Robin? Were you surprised?
No, I was not surprised. That was my pick. I was actually, the thing I've been a bit surprised about is how willing people are, you know, to really just rave about Almeida's skills. Because being able to put together really nice combinations is beautiful to watch. But that's not what winners are made of. Thomas Almeida, before the UFC, I think it was Garbrandt, somebody was like, yeah, he knocked out 16 cab drivers. Now, and I don't remember who exactly said that. I found that funny. Mm-hmm. And then he got to the UFC and he got a decision, and then he's looked very good. The Brad Pickett fight, people pointed to that as a sign of how great Almeida is. To me, it was a sign of how defensively liable he can be at times. And I never like to criticize. So I try not to look at it critically like that. And I try to look for the positive. And going into this one, I was like, Thomas Almeida needs a loss. Because for him to improve, when shit gets tough, his answer is will through it. And just bite down and push through it and trust your offense. He's offensively brilliant. But that doesn't mean he's – and there were people talking about him fighting for a title. You know what Dominic Cruz would do to Thomas Almeida? He moves straight forward and straight back and straight side right and straight side left. You can't be a champion. You can't even be really top five. I know he was ranked, I think, at number four, but that's not real. I mean, he throws really beautiful offensive combinations. And when Garbrandt won, he was like, this kid could be a champ one day. Absolutely, he could be a champ one day. But he needed to lose. And he needed to lose because of that, because he's been built around moving straight forward and straight back. You can't win moving straight forward and straight back. Doesn't matter how offensively brilliant you were. And when Garbrandt was looking at it and saying, oh, this is a perfect fight for me, I was too. I was looking at it going, this guy's – the way he moves his feet – I mean, Stipe Miocic just beat Verdume with footwork. You know, it was a different scenario. It was transfer of potential energy, like amortization of potential energy while backing up to kind of decelerate really fast, amortize the energy, and accelerate forward. This is different, but it's the same principle. Quick direction change is an athletic trait, but it's also skill development. And Garbrandt has built his game around it. So even when it looks like he's moving forward, right hand, left hook, you watch his feet. When you watch Garbrandt fight, watch his feet. And this fight, go back. It's not even a round. Watch their feet. Almeida's moving his feet forward and he's moving his feet back. He's like, if you looked at him from space, he would look like a plus sign. You know, his movement forward, back, side, side. Garbrandt is like asterisks with circles around them. You know, and if you put those two things together and you tell me which one, you know, is likely to poke the other one, it's going to be the asterisk, right? And so I figured this is how it was going to go. I didn't, you know, you can't say it would go in the first round, but, and you can't, And you can't go out there and tell people to – I don't tell people to bet money on things because Almeida, with incredible offense like that, all he's got to do is land one strong thing, stun Garbrandt, and then just blast forward, full shoot-a-box, straightforward in combination. So he can totally win. They could run this fight 10 times. I think Garbrandt would win 7. But maybe he'd only win 6. Maybe he'd win 8. It's hard to tell. But he has the skill to beat a guy like Almeida. And just like I was saying about Sterling, Almeida needed a loss. And he needed a loss to look back and not say, oh, I got caught. He needs to look back and go, this guy is playing a different sport than me. How do I do that? And that, again, ties into Barão a little bit. In round one, Barão, who had been beaten up, so Barão lost the first time. He was just out footwork. He was out movement. It was complexity that beat him. This after, when he went to fight the second time, he lied to himself. And he said, I just got rocked in round one. If I didn't get rocked in round one with that lucky punch, it would be different. Mm-hmm. He changes nothing. He goes back and he gets destroyed even worse. Now he comes back for this fight in round one. He had put some of those elements in. He had understood, oh, that's real. This guy can do things I can't do. That's literally like learning a different martial art. I got to work on it. So he went ahead and he worked on it. It worked in round one. It's not quite there yet, but he'll keep working on it. That's what Almeida needs to do. And, you know, I hope that's what my guy Uriah Faber did a little bit too, because he's going to deal with that next weekend.
Yeah, that's right. And that's going to be very, very exciting. Robin, we really appreciate the time. Final question. We'll let you go. We know how busy you are. What's next for Cody? Who would you like to see him up next?
Oh, that's a good question. You know who he's going – I'll tell you who's probably going to fight next, unless there is a fight that I'm not – oh, there is. Who's TJ Dillashaw fighting?
Rafael Assuncao.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because Garbrandt, I don't know that would be a smart move yet, but, you know, there's a built-in, you know, I hate this guy and I'll say stuff and then everybody will get excited about it. Well, how about Caraway? I mean, that's a logical one. That's a tough fight, but he's a different beast. Caraway beat Sterling by going, well, Caraway's a 7 out of 10, 7.5 out of 10 in boxing if, you know, the best boxer in MMA is 10. And he felt Sterling in the boxing range was a 6. So he pushed it there, and that was the key to it. But he can't do that with Garbrandt. Garbrandt will eat him up there. So now he has to, against Garbrandt, he'd have to go back to that game Sterling played and stay way on the outside, and hope to get him down. Yeah, I like that fight. I think Garbrandt has a lot of advantages in that fight, and I bet you that's the fight.
There you go. Book it now. I mean, Brian Caraway is not the guy that you want to go up against if you want to make yourself look good. And obviously the UFC have a potential star in Cody Garbrandt. So obviously best of luck to him if that fight gets made. But I love it. We always love chatting to you, Robin. We appreciate the time. Guys, don't forget to catch Robin on Twitter at Robin Black. He has a ton of insight, encyclopedia insight. And make sure to watch him on the Fight Network. Plenty of great content. Robin, again, thank you so much for chatting to us. We love having you on.
Thank you guys so much, and keep up the good work.
All right, there you guys go, Robin Black. Always a pleasure having him on the program. So much insight. Talk to the guy all day long, but he's a busy man. No doubt about it. He will be back on Submission Radio in the future, and hopefully we'll do some more breakdowns and really get into the nitty-gritty when it comes to MMA. But another event in the bookcast and another episode of Submission Radio. What a show it has been this week. So many great guests. So much fun. It's been a really wild ride so far.
It has been a super wild ride. I think this is literally the most guests that we've ever had. And I think this is probably officially the longest show that we've ever done. A huge thank you to all those guests, Gunnar Nelson, Ariel Helwani, Hector Lombard, Max Holloway, Chris Van Heerden, and just a few seconds ago, Robin Black. Really appreciate all those guys making this such a big show. And of course, to you yourself for listening right now, and hopefully you're enjoying the show. We don't really have time for much else. We do have a stack of fan questions, but we're going to get around to them next week. Because next week's show, as we mentioned before, is going to be a bit smaller. We're going to be breaking down UFC 199. No guests, per se. Probably get one or two journalists on there to break it down. And we'll have plenty of time for fan questions then. But before we let you go, a couple of things. Dennis and I, we both saw X-Men Apocalypse. That's out in cinemas at the moment. People talking about it. We saw it completely separate. We just happened to realize that we've both seen it. So we figured we'll do a bit of a review on it before we let you go. Dennis, just your thoughts on X-Men Apocalypse. What did you think of it?
Yeah, it was one of those things where there's been so many superhero movies lately, that he started to compare him to the other ones. And when I watched X-Men, this was after watching Captain America Civil War, and obviously we watched Deadpool together, also Batman versus Superman. So I couldn't help but compare it to those movies. And I will say that I thought X-Men Apocalypse was a solid movie. I enjoyed it, but it was one of those things where I wasn't as interested in the origin story tale anymore. I almost wished that I forgot about the fact of where they were going. And when this movie came out, a big part of me just wanted to see the regular X-Men, if that makes sense, and not sort of this origin story anymore. And with Deadpool out and all of that, all those movies coming out, I just sort of wanted to see the characters that we know and love. So I thought this was a solid movie. To me, it went a little bit long. I thought it wasn't, I didn't think it was as good as Captain America Civil War or even Deadpool. I think it holds its own, but to me it was just a little bit disappointing because of the fact that it was a little bit lackluster to me.
Yeah.
I felt like it just didn't – I really liked the previous two movies. I really enjoyed them.
Remind me again, with X-Men, what was the last one? And what do you mean by origins? Because this wasn't actually an origins one. This was part of the actual, you know, X-Men as X-Men. It wasn't like a Wolverine movie or anything like that.
So like an origins for X-Men. So this is, you know, how things came together, how Professor Xavier became bald. This is a sort of a prequel
to the
X-Men movies that we know and love. And it's been going on for a while now, a couple of movies now. Let me have a look.
Because I'll be honest, I've actually really liked these prequels to everything else. I hate the most recent Wolverine movie where he was in Japan.
Terrible.
I thought that was the stupidest movie
ever.
Both
of them horrible, I reckon.
Which the first one was, look, it was enjoyable, but it was pretty meh. Like the way they did Weapon X and they kind of killed off Deadpool, that was ridiculous and stupid. The one in Japan was just horrendous. It was like a romance movie. It was literally just an excuse for Hugh Jackman to take his shirt off so the chicks would see it. There was, I think, literally three mutants in that whole movie. It was horrendous. I hated it with a passion. I mean, kudos to Hugh Jackman. He did look great. But like X-Men Days of Future Past, the last one with McAvoy as Professor Xavier, I've been loving that one. And where it showed how he became paralyzed, and then, you know, X-Men Days of Future Past, where it was like, you had both origin stories. You had like Ian McKellen as Magneto, and you had Michael Fassbender, or whatever his name is, as Magneto. I love that one. Did you not like that?
Yeah. So I liked X-Men First Class, and I liked X-Men Days of Future Past.
Mm-hmm.
But when this movie came out, I was over the story arc.
Okay.
And I wasn't really interested in watching more. To me, it felt like X-Men First Class and X-Men Days of Future Past. It had sort of more characters, to me, better storylines. It was more interesting. Mm. When it came to this one, I guess the biggest revelation that the fans sort of found out was how Professor Xavier went bald, like in a lot of ways. Like nothing huge came out of it.
That
sort of makes sense to people listening. Like First Class was super interesting. In Days of Future Past, I loved how they had that whole storyline. You know, Professor Xavier's just all like, wasted and like hungover and all this shit.
Yeah,
but I love James McAvoy. I think he's such a good actor. And actually, he holds the movie together for me. But with this one, apart from him and Jennifer Lawrence, it just didn't feel. I don't know. It just wasn't there for me. It was a good movie, but it just wasn't there for me. But anyway, what about you, Cass? What else did you think about this one?
I found that this one is a little bit more serious than the previous ones. There wasn't as much jokey stuff. Like, you've got Deadpool, which is like on the far side of the spectrum, where it's just like jokes every 2 seconds, literally. And then there's X-Men, which is usually dialed back, but still quite a bit of humor and still kind of like a fun superhero movie. This one, to me, wasn't as fun. It was a little bit more serious. The other thing is, like, Apocalypse, I'm going to be honest, like, I didn't know much about the Apocalypse character. I remember playing X-Men vs. Street Fighter on arcade machines way back in the day. And I remember at the end, you'd have Apocalypse, and, you know, he was a super tough bad guy at boss and would just, you know, turn into a whole bunch of things. But other than that, I didn't know much about Apocalypse. And I feel like after watching this movie, I still didn't know much about Apocalypse. I don't think they really brought out the character well. I think the character looked a little bit stupid. Just kind of looked like... I don't know, just some blue guy. It reminded me of, I don't know if you saw that Power Rangers movie like years and years ago, like 15, 20 years ago with Ivan Ooze. Kind of reminded me of him. He just looked like, I don't know, silly and blue. And in the comics and in like the video games, Apocalypse actually looks like a badass. Here, he just kind of looked a little bit lost. So I didn't really like that. And I agree with you that where the movie just dragged on, and it was like, I feel like 85% of the movie was lead up.
And then the last 15, it was all a big lead up to that last big 15%. And then it kind of gets to that 15%. And you're like, well, was it really worth it? Was it really worth, you know, the previous hour and 45 minutes for this last 15 minutes? Of course, you got a big fight scene, a big blow off. And I didn't really find it that satisfying. I feel like towards the end, they try to cram a lot of, you know, what makes Apocalypse Apocalypse in the very end, like where he was. I don't want to spoil anything, but yeah, I don't know. The problem that I have with this movie is the same one that I have with, say, The Hateful Eight, which is it's such a huge lead-up that goes kind of nowhere.
Yeah, yeah, 2 hours and 24 minutes.
Wow.
And it just feels like, even though you do have new dudes playing like Cyclops and Storm, and you got Nightcrawler in there, it just doesn't feel like you have all those sort of interesting X-Men characters that even in the previous movies, it was just more interesting. Mm. And it's interesting. It's going to be interesting to see what they do going forward, because I was watching an interview with Jennifer Lawrence and James McAvoy where they asked them, are you guys going to do any more movies? And they were pretty hesitant about it. Mm. So they've sort of put themselves in a very interesting place where do you go from here? Are you going to restart it from scratch? Are we going to go back over the original movies? And now that you've got, you know, recast Cyclops and Storm, are you just going to use new actors to play those characters? Or are you going to do something else with it? What are you going to do with it? Because you're sort of caught up now to the stage where we first started almost with the first X-Men movie. So what are you going to do next? And also, if you do something next, is it going to be interesting enough to hold a movie together? Because this story just didn't feel as interesting as the previous two.
I feel like, yeah, this, I don't know, given that Apocalypse just seems like such a badass, they could have done a lot more with it. And I feel like it was a little bit wasted. And you're right, if they're, like, I don't want them to recast any of these characters, because I love Michael Fassbender as Magneto. I like Jennifer Lawrence as Mystique. You know, McAvoy is awesome. All these people are awesome. The chick who played Storm, I mean, she was okay. The funny thing is, in the first X-Men movie, the first big one, I think it was like 2000 that it came out, Storm had the accent, and I don't know exactly what her origin was. I thought it was like South African, but maybe it's Egyptian. And then the next two movies, she just lost it, completely gone. No explanation. Mm. She's just American now. And in this one, you know, I guess it was Egypt where Storm, you know, they picked Storm out from, and now she has an accent. So I found that interesting, that, okay, the accent's all over the place. And one of the things that people have always laughed at with all these X-Men movies is the continuity and the timelines and the time frames is just all over the place. But, yeah, I'm with you, man. Just when you like a bunch of actors, you know, sometimes they recast people. Kind of like with Spider-Man, although I did like Spider-Man in the latest Captain America movie. So,
yeah. It's interesting. And I'm not sure what the situation is. Maybe you know a bit more than me about this, but who owns X-Men? It's not a part of Marvel, is it? It's owned by Fox or something. Or
no, I think Deadpool is owned by Fox. I don't know. I thought it's either Marvel or it might be Disney. It might actually be Disney.
Yeah, I'm just having a look at it here, and so Fox owns the screen rights to X-Men and Fantastic Four, which stops them from putting them in Marvel movies. Which with the whole Deadpool thing, I'm not exactly sure where that leaves Deadpool.
Well, I guess that makes sense because
he can't be a part of the Avengers and all those Marvel movies, basically, or something like that. Or maybe he can, but
X-Men can be in Deadpool.
X-Men can be in Deadpool, yeah. So it's pretty confusing. But with Sony, they gave up on Spider-Man. They tried to bring him back with like you mentioned, and it was decent. The second movie was decent, but they sort of gave up and they passed it over to Marvel to do their thing. It's looking like it's going to be really, really good. It kind of limits the possibilities a little bit when you think that X-Men can't really interact with some of the other awesome Marvel characters like, you know, like I don't know, Iron Man and all that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I'm just interested what they're going to do next, because I hate to go back and past again, but X-Men Days of Future Past, that was such a smart storyline because they were going back and forward. You had, you know, you went to the future, then when you were back, that was really interesting. I just don't know what's left for them to do with this one. I mean, yeah. It'll be interesting. If they do recast it, it'll be funny because they'll still probably pay Hugh Jackman huge money to be Wolverine, and you'll have him playing Wolverine all the way back in the first movie and in this one. So I wonder how long Hugh Jackman can even stay in that shape for. That's crazy as well. So he's looked pretty good though. 16 years of playing Wolverine. He's looked really good.
Wow, 16 years. I will
imagine staying in that shape for 16 years.
I don't think he does. I think he kind of goes in and out. I know Ryan Reynolds, I saw an interview with him, and he was saying he does not stay in shape between his movies because it's really hard. Like, you hear about, you know, the diets that they're on. It's just, like, shitty, crappy food, just lean chicken and broccoli, basically. And, you know, Hugh Jackman will be working out for, like, 3 hours a day, I think 6 days a week, and he's intermittent fasting and do all this stuff. And I apparently his wife likes him a little bit on the thicker side, not so shredded. And I was actually watching another interview, and Hugh Jackman, you know that fight scene in that last Wolverine movie where it's just like ridiculously shredded, shirt off? He actually did a cut. So he was like, oh, I did a water dehydration, like blah, blah, blah. Yeah, you cut weight basically. So he cut weight, he did a workout that day, and apparently he had like a massive migraine throughout that whole scene. So it just makes you think, like, you know, they show up on set, and it's not even the, you know, year or 8 months or however many, you know, how many months or time they've spent working out. It's whatever they did that day as well. It's crazy to think that he did a cut.
It's interesting because Wolverine doesn't age. So he definitely has a limited amount of time that he can play Wolverine.
He wants to play forever.
That's the thing. Like, you can't recast Wolverine. Or, like, it'll be super tough to recast Wolverine. Everybody loves Hugh Jackman playing Wolverine. And he's played Wolverine in the past movies. So, yeah, I don't know. I don't know where they're going to go with this, but I'll give you my scorecast. Out of Timothy Johnson mustaches, I'm going to give it 2¾ mustache out of 5. I think it was a decent watch. If you compare it, if you put it next to Captain America Civil War, it's nowhere near as good. If you put it next to Days of Future Past, you'd be a bit disappointed. But as a standalone movie that you sit down and watch, I still think it has something in it where it's decent, but it's just not great. And definitely do not start watching this movie like I did at 9:30 p.m. at the movies, because you're going to struggle to stay awake.
I think I watched it at 10:45. How's that? Jesus. I think I got out of the cinemas at like 2 in the morning. No, maybe not 2. But it was something like that. Once you have previews and then the 30 movie.
30-minute previews.
Yeah, so it's 3 hours. 3 hours in the cinema.
Jesus.
I know. So look, I'm gonna look, I like that. 2¾. I like that. I don't think it's enough to push it to 3 Timothy Johnson mustaches, because then we're saying it's above average. I guess it is above average. I don't know. Look, it's just...
It's better than Batman versus Superman. If you put it next to Batman versus Superman, you're like, my day just got a lot better.
Cancer is better than Batman versus Superman. I'm just saying, like, this is not a very memorable movie to me. You know? You watch it, you're like, all right, cool. I was always going to watch it. You know what was memorable for me? Olivia Munn as Psylocke.
God, yeah, no, she was great. Yeah, she's great.
Well, she wasn't great, but she was hot.
She looks great for her age.
How old is she? Is she old?
Let's have a look here. This is important.
Olivia Munn, surrender your secrets to me. Just don't Google image Olivia Munn. Well, I mean, do, but I'm just saying, if you're looking for age, you're gonna get a lot more than what you bargained for. She's 35. Wow, she looks great for 35.
Yeah, great. Okay, so you found 35 looks great.
You want to hear something crazy? I never found Olivia Munn hot. I don't know why. It's just this weird thing that I have until I saw her in this movie. And I was like, fuck, is that Olivia Munn? God damn.
Oh, wow. Yeah, when did I find her hot for the first time? She's been in a few things that I've liked, but I forgot about it and remembered her in this movie. So I guess in a lot of ways it had a good effect on me as well. But there you go. 35 years old, Olivia Munn looked great. We're not saying she was Al Pacino great in the movie, but she looked great.
Hoo-ha! Yeah, it needs a bit more of that. And she was in Iron Man 2, but I don't remember in Iron Man 2 at all. Do you remember who she was?
Was she like an assistant or something?
I don't know.
Iron Man 2, I wish I could forget that movie. That was terrible.
Was that the one with Mickey Rourke?
Yeah, remember that one?
Yeah. Mickey Rourke is a Russian. Apparently, he went to Russia, spent like months in there, and did all this preparation. Apparently, most of the stuff they filmed with him didn't make it to the movie. He said the best parts of his scenes ended up on the cutting room floor. There you go. Fun fact.
Yeah, speaking of the cutting room floor, I really like her in this show called The Newsroom, but that's just off topic. So, yeah, so it's a decent movie. If you go to watch it, what it suggests is probably just wait till it comes out on DVD, because it is a big commitment to watch it in the cinemas. It is a big commitment. I feel like if you were at home, you're on your own schedule, blah, 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 it's a bit easier. At the movies, 3 hours. You're looking at 3 hours. These 30-minute movie previews, I mean, seriously, someone's got to do something about this. We need a politician. And one of the main focus points is forget healthcare, reduce these movie preview times, man. This is ridiculous.
Man, I love the movie previews. I think you and I are on polar opposites on this. I love the movie previews. It gets me excited. And because I'm always late to everything, it gives me leeway. This is the one time in life where I win. The one time where I can be late, I can be my usual self, and I still come up ahead.
Why do they always put those electrical company ads in movies? What is it about watching movies that makes you want to change your electric provider?
Oh, those ones, yeah. I don't know. I guess they pay the
big
bucks.
I love watching previews for like the upcoming movies, but I hate the ads. And a lot of the times, the ads have nothing to do with the actual product. Like you'll see a wet turtle, a dry rag, a wooden board, and then it'll be like, come visit Adelaide.
yes. I
You're
saw
like,
that
what does this
ad?
Have
yes.
to do with Adelaide? And yeah. why am I watching this?
Yeah. Yeah, full on. I know exactly which ad you're talking about. But anyway, things to take away from this week's episode. X-Men Apocalypse, 2 3/4 Timothy Johnson mustaches. Mm-hmm. Gunnar Nelson's awesome. Ariel Helwani's awesome. Hector Lombard's awesome. Max Holloway's awesome. Robin Black's awesome. Chris Van Heerden is awesome and also a nice guy. And Olivia Munn is hot. And that's
Hector
the big
Lombard's
takeaway.
Hector Lombard's nice.
Hector Lombard's hot as well. There you go. Yeah. Everyone's hot.
So hot right now.
But not as hot as Olivia Munn. Anyway, that's it from us. What a note to end on. Say nothing else. Let it be awkward. Let it be awkward for a week until everybody hears from us again. We'll be back next week with a short show. We'll be doing a UFC 199 breakdown. Anything else to mention, Dennis?
Just jump on Twitter. Give us your thoughts. Tell us what you thought about the episode. Comment section below, Facebook. And other than that, we'll catch you guys next week.